OTB AM. This is OTB Sports Radio.
Yeah, you're very welcome along to OTB AM on OTB Sports Radio. It's 7:31 this morning. We're glad to have you with us. We're here all the way until 9:30 and we're here every day of the week. You can get us, the best way to get us is on youtube.com/offtheball or indeed the Go Loud app where you can download the app and have OTB Sports Radio in your ears for 24 hours a day. Maura Trass is with us today. How are you?
Come on, how are you?
I'm very well. We've been talking a lot of Mayo on the show over the course of the last week and we're not going to change the habit of the week.
No.
Just because Joe Brawley has written a great piece today.
He has written a great piece.
Sorry, and Kieran Cunningham has written a great piece.
Based on what Joe Brawley has said. That is very true. Kieran Cunningham wrote it. Joe Brawley is talking about it. Of course, we'll talk about it at length. But this is where I have to say, of course, I am from Galway. We can't be throwing stones either, but I'll throw a bit.
Do you not love it? Is this not like the perfect Galway story where you're looking over the fence at what's happening in Mayo and going, whoa, I'm glad they've taken the heat off us. I mean, Pat McDonagh literally put out two statements about how bad things were in Galway and everybody's talking about Mayo. Things couldn't be better.
Well, maybe if not if you're Pat McDonagh. I mean, I don't know. Pat might want to bring the light back a little bit to Galway. I don't know. It's horrible to see in one sense. It's very entertaining because it's like a little soap opera. But I mean, we can say it's entertaining because we're not the ones who've been paying money to go to Mayo games. If you were from Mayo, I'd imagine. I know for me personally, I'm not sure at the moment would I be comfortable paying in the gates for some of these games at the moment. When you don't know where the money's going, what's going on, when people obviously aren't happy, you want a little bit more transparency. But it's still a great story.
Especially if you're not there. I think if you're a Mayo fan, you're there to support the team though. Like if you're a Mayo supporter, you're there to support the team. So thick or thin, hell or high water, no matter what shower are in charge or what shower are doing whatever, is that not the contract that every GA supporter makes? I am a supporter of this team because I am a GA person.
Yes, absolutely. But at the same time, as a supporter of that team, you're handing over money, you're putting diesel in the car, you're packing the ham sandwiches, you're paying for the carvery, you're taking the kids. You kind of want to know that where that money is going at the very least, that it's going to make that team the best they can be. And I'm not sure if you're a Mayo fan at the moment that you can be fully confident in that.
Okay, that's a fair point. So we'll come back to the story a little bit later on. You were in the sports grounds to witness the pummeling that your boys took from Leinster at the weekend.
Oh, mother of God. I was so delighted going down. I was going home to Galway for the weekend. I was staying in Galway Friday night. I was going out. I was going back to Carrow the following day. The weather was lovely. It didn't rain once.
Right, I don't believe you, but go on.
There was no wind, and I think maybe that's why Connacht took that pummeling.
Right.
It was Leinster weather in Galway, and they just weren't used to it. It was odd. I've never seen a Connacht collapse, over the years, back in the day, but it's been a long time, not since maybe the latter years of Eric Elwood did I see such a pummeling for Connacht that was completely unexpected. There was a brilliant vibe in the sports ground. The air just came out of it, and I hate to say it, but from half time, I was in the tent.
Right.
I couldn't cope. Fair weather fan. Literally.
But Connacht are actually decent at the moment. That's the thing.
They are.
So that's
why
it was a surprise.
Yeah, they bounced back. They had a great game there a few weeks ago. I mean, you might remember the swirling rain and wind. They were down. They kept going. They kept going. They finally got that try and everything to win the game. It was fantastic. And it was weird. You could tell as well the players, I feel, they weren't expecting it either. They looked shell-shocked, which is why that pummeling continued. They didn't know how to react. It wasn't in the script. They had no plan B. They didn't know how to bounce back from it. It was weird is the best word I can come up with it. It was even I looked up the press box in some stage and I could see some of the journalists just they were doing this with their biros. There was no explanation for it. Leinster just continually picked holes and Connacht had no way of stitching up the holes.
Leinster are pretty good at the minute. That's the other side of this.
They are, but at the same time there was a host of internationals back and that kind of thing, and you could argue the last time Connacht did really well was after a Rugby World Cup, because obviously they weren't as pillaged for players as say Leinster and Munster would have been. So they should have been in a great position.
Yeah.
And they weren't, so
I still think they're going to have a good season, and a lot will look. The European campaign is going to be huge for them, just in terms of a shot in the arm for the momentum from a supporter's perspective, from the business side of things, and just to remind everybody that this is a European team as opposed to just a Pro 14 team.
And so I think perhaps maybe that Montpellier game which is coming up may have been in the backs of minds as well, which is understandable, and that plays into your mind if you're thinking, I don't want to get injured here playing Leinster in Pro 14. When, I could be playing in a European Cup game in a few weeks' time.
And they have no second rows at the moment as well. So we'll talk about that a little bit later on. Ruaidhri O'Connor is going to come in and join us in studio just after 8 o'clock. Here's what else is coming up. We're going to get to the sports pages in just a couple of minutes. Talking Champions Cup, that's the Heineken Cup with Rory around about 8:05. Talking a bit more Mayo GA. That's just a permanent fixture on our running order. Some days we get to it, some days we don't. But we just leave it there on the off chance that, something's going to happen today that we'll end up talking about Mayo GA. Sports news around about 8:30. Damien Delaney is going to talk to us about the Ireland team tonight for the game against New Zealand. I can't call them the All Whites. It's a ridiculous name. We're playing New Zealand. We're playing their soccer team. They play in white. Who cares? We're going to talk with Damien Delaney about that. We'll also obviously talk about the game against Denmark on Monday. And then the ATP Tour, it's the end of season competition that happens in London. It's like the richest thing in world sport. And we're going to talk to Colm Boohig about that a little bit later on. And then Martyn Irvine is the coach of the Irish track cycling team, who won a gold in the World Championships for the first time in 150 years. So he's going to join us in studio around about 9:15. A very busy show. Time for the papers.
OTB AM.
So I'm going to start with the Irish Independent this morning. And Parrott can give me good problem, says McCarthy. This is Mick McCarthy talking about whether or not Troy Parrott can actually play some football. He's obviously going to start the game. Which was, in fairness, we were talking about this yesterday in the show, and it was like, oh, he's... wouldn't it be great if you would just tell everybody you started them, so might add some bums on seats? And lo and behold, 25 minutes later, they announced a team, and Burns playing, Parrott's playing. It's a great night. I hope it does actually add around 5,000 or 10,000 bums on seat as locals walk up and see.
Yeah, it's a great opportunity. Like, I know people say it's friendly, what's the point? But if you want to bring your kids to a game, if you want to see local boys playing, which is not always an opportunity you have, like I said, to rock up, why wouldn't you?
Yeah, I think so.
Especially against the famous All Whites.
Exactly. Who haven't played a game for 556 days or whatever it is. I think Jack Byrne is from Dublin inner city, like about less than a mile away from Wes, and I don't know if he's talking about him being the new Wes in his piece today. And like, maybe this will actually help the local community there realise that we've produced a bunch of Ireland footballers over the last while, and we continue to produce them. And so I don't know, I just think it's important that the Dublin crowd gets out tonight and supports Jack Byrne and gives him an opportunity to, you know, feel the love of the Aviva. Because
yeah,
otherwise, I don't think, it's not a very attractive game.
No.
And if the weather is like, so the weather's actually really good this morning compared to yesterday, which was biblical. There was snow lying on the ground in parts of Kildare, and it lashed all day in Dublin. So if the weather was like yesterday, today, then I'm sure that there'll be no walk-up crowd, but it looks like it's going to be a nice, cool, crisp evening and clear and dry, so...
Well, what will motivate you to walk up to it?
Jack Byrne playing. Troy Parrott getting a start. Yeah, absolutely. Like, you know, that's the type of thing that you can go and say, right, this is the future of our team, it's an exciting team, and they're going to be given an opportunity, and they are of this football culture. And actually, they're the best part of this football culture. Young lads who are trying to be ambitious and trying to get hold of the ball and not trying to hoof the ball forward and just play to instruction. So that's exactly what, and I think that's what's going to hopefully animate a reasonable walk-up crowd tonight. I want to talk about the other two stories here as well. Club finals to be replaced by under 20 action on St. Patrick's Day. So obviously we know that the All-Ireland club finals are going to be taking place on a different date this year. They've been moved to January, and it looks like the under 20s football championship is going to be the centrepiece of St. Patrick's Day in Croke Park.
How do you feel about that? Ambivalent.
Well, I think that it could be a great, you know, in the future when the pre-season competition is our provincial competitions, and then everything else is just a league and championship hybrid, then you could have provincial final day on St. Patrick's Day.
Yeah.
Straight knockout from the start of February in all the four provinces. So you still have a trophy, and it's a good trophy at the start of the year that everybody's like, oh, this is, you know, our 54th if you're whatever county, or our third for others. And it's a big deal and something, and you could have those finals on St. Patrick's. Well, you can have two on St. Patrick's Day and two on the following Sunday or the previous Sunday if St. Patrick's Day doesn't fall now. So that week. It could be a festival of football.
Like the way the All-Ireland semi-finals are supposed to be.
Back-to-back days.
Yeah.
Yeah. What do you think?
I don't know. It's just that time of year. I can't get on board with it. Like, I tried. I don't know. I used to be really into it. And then over the last few years, maybe it's just apathy from going to so many games and sitting in the cold. But I remember sitting in Croke Park last St. Patrick's Day, frozen to the bone, working, and nobody there. And there was zero atmosphere. And maybe, now again, the games didn't help. Thomas's, obviously, they...
Blowout.
There was a blowout. And then obviously Corfin blew Croke's out. And that was a game everyone was really excited for. We were all building it up. I spent an hour on radio telling every people this game is going to be great. And
yeah. What
the hell do I know? And so you kind of find yourself wondering, should we be in Croke Park at all St. Patrick's Day? I don't know.
I think if you can fill it and put stuff on and bring a bit of entertainment as well.
If you can fill it, but what's going to fill it?
It's unlikely the under-20s are going to fill it. Like, let's all be completely honest about that. You could put six games on back to back, and I don't know, maybe if you made it three in or five in, even then, I just think that ultimately it's set up for either the start of something or the end of something. So if it's the start of our proper championship on St. Patrick's Day, which isn't going to happen, but in the current calendar, it's difficult to see anything that could fit there.
Do we have to be there on St. Patrick's Day, I suppose, is the bigger question. I can understand why the GAA don't want to let go of that calendar day because it's got such a strong association, but at the same time, they let go of September, which I think is a much bigger deal. And yet people seem to be really clinging on to the St. Patrick's Day notion there must be something happening in Croke Park.
I don't know. It's a good point. It's not the day of the best weather in the country. Sometimes it snows, sometimes it's sunny, sometimes the wind howls and it rains. And
can't drive anywhere because of all the parades.
Yeah. Difficult to get to. I don't know. I guess.
I just want a day off on St. Patrick's Day. I worked in RTE for years covering parades. Then I came here and I've been doing club finals.
What was the worst parade you covered?
Oh, Tour Macedi.
What?
God love them. And they tried. They really, really tried. It was, God, I think 2008, 2009. I think it was one of their first parades, you know, right. They were trying to get coverage for it, so I was sent up.
Where is Tour Macedi?
Tour Macedi is in the Mayo Gaeltacht. It's a lovely little village, actually. It's really, really nice. It's where McLally, Miley from Glenroe is from.
Oh, right, okay.
Yeah,
okay.
It's actually a lovely part of the country. And it was one of their first or their second parade, so they were still getting used to it, you know. There was two tractors, a float, kids with tin whistles.
And that was it?
Yeah, and I was meant to pull a minute 20 out of it.
Wow. Walk and talk, here we are.
Yeah, and then there was...
So
and
this
then
is the start of it.
My last
Do you think
parade,
it'll get better in years to come?
Oh, I hope so. My last parades actually were in Galway. I did the Galway parade. It was torrential, bucketing downpour, like okay, biblical, cartoon-like. Changed my clothes, and then I had to go up to do Ballinrobe's parade, and then the rain just followed me up.
Oh, wow.
Oh, it was awful.
I presume Ballinrobe's a bit of crack. Galway's like big and Mockness and stuff, is it? Or
yeah, Galway is too big.
Right.
Like, you see, it depends. See, there's two schools of thought with parades on St. Patrick's Day.
Right.
You have, like, your marching band, people marching in tune, which is all very professional looking and slick, but quite dull, which is, I'm going to get shot for this, which is, like, the big town parades. And then you go to your small local parades. Like, I remember the last time I went to my parade at home in Kerry Row, we had a guy pretending to be Miley Cyrus on a wrecking ball. And that just confused, I like that.
I mean, what? Was he dressed as Miley Cyrus in the video?
Yeah, he was, yeah. And he had a big kind of paper mache type wrecking ball thing. And
right. They
were blasting the song out. And he just swung back and forth while the parade starts off in the middle of the village outside Teen Toiler in the hall and goes all the way back to T. Josie, the local nightclub.
Right.
Turns around and comes back.
Perfect. I mean, that's like, you know.
To me, that's a much better parade. There's more creativity in it. And, you know, people coming with no money and coming up with ideas. I just enjoy that more than majorettes marching in the rain.
Yeah, I that sounds amazing.
But don't get me wrong, the Mockness element and everything of Galway is really cool, but I think the Mockness Halloween parade is much better than St. Patrick's Day stuff.
I haven't seen the St. Patrick's one in years, but the Halloween stuff is always amazing. And sorry, I want to talk about this as well. Last one for me for now from the Irish Independent as our parades correspondent. We should send you to the 12th. That would be good.
Myself and Brian O'Driscoll with the lambay drums.
Irish players arrogant towards Wales. Gatland. So Warren Gatland was in the studio yesterday with Joe. It's a great interview. It's about 47 minutes, so you should dig that out wherever you listen to your podcast. The best place for us is offtheball.com/podcasts or the Go Loud app. And he, Rory's picked through the three really big things from it. One is that he said that he thought one of his own Welsh players was doping at one point. Didn't go into what he did about it.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't go into what level of care, responsibility, or you know, what influence he exerted on the player he thought might be doping. It was just a thought he had. Didn't say he confronted the player or examined it, or didn't say whether or not he continued to pick him or dropped him. But anyway, the other one is that he was talking about the Irish players being a bit arrogant towards Wales. Some of the Welsh boys are envious of the Irish province's success, and then sometimes they felt there has been, and rightly so sometimes, a bit of arrogance towards them from the Irish players about their success. As a result, they've kind of become that motivation for the Welsh boys, saying we can't beat them at regional level, but they know we've got a chance at international level. So basically, this is one of his things that he obviously had been using through the years, Irish arrogance. And maybe we were arrogant. Maybe those Irish players were arrogant.
I don't know about the Irish players, but definitely some of the Irish fans were.
Yeah.
Well, they had reason to be for a while, to be fair.
Yeah, exactly. We were way better than them for ages, and then they kept winning Grand Slams and championships when we couldn't. Then Joe Schmidt came in, and we obviously were much better than them up until the most important year of all time, which was 2019. I want to play you this bit, though, because this is how he talked about getting under Joe Schmidt's skin. Have a look.
Because I know that it ends up coming back to you. You talk to people. Joe Schmidt seems to get more wound up the week that Ireland are playing Wales, because if I say anything, it absolutely drives them crazy. So if I, you know, so there have been one or two times when I've, you know, said about, you know, Ireland.
Because you sense it'll get under his skin more than others.
Absolutely.
So Eddie Jones will laugh it off, but you suspect it bothers Joe.
It does bother Joe, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and he might deny that, but it's people within the Irish camp are telling me, saying, please don't say anything this week, because Joe will go mental about any comments that you make. So, you know,
well, I wonder what you do then. Straight away, that's like waving a red flag.
No, it's not. Look, if you ever look at, I've definitely toned down. You know, I don't. If you look at the World Cup, you know, what comments did I say? And really, apart from the Six Nations, where I made one comment at the start, if we win the first game.
Which wasn't outlandish, actually, the way the fixtures were.
Yeah, so, Mark Gatlin seems to enjoy the rough and tumble of being an international manager. I think he's going to miss it for the little period of time that he's not going to be one.
I think we'll miss it too for that little period of time, but I really want to know who the people were in the Irish camp who were telling him this.
I mean,
or if he's making that up as well.
That's also fairly, I mean, when you're hearing it, you're like, there's not a whole heap of people, I would say, who are potentially in the frame for that, so...
Yeah, that's what you'd be thinking.
What have you got for us?
I have loads. This is the Irish Daily Mail I have here, and at the back we have a photo of Jason Smith, who is the great... 8 is great for Smith, so that's... Sometimes we just don't hear enough about the Paralympics and the amount of stuff they do, especially Jason Smith. He's legendary, everything he's doing. There's lots of different things. You're not normally coming up to football week. There's not much aside from football, but there's loads in the papers today. So obviously, taking flight, all I want to do is score goals, says Parrot. 3 French clubs in the hunt for Bundia Key, apparently,
yes.
Which I'm not sure we'd be happy to hear about that in Galway. And row over O'Leary place on Arsenal bow. David O'Leary, apparently, is a source of tension among Arsenal's hierarchy, with chairperson facing resistance in his bid to induct the former captain on the club's board as a consultant. So, obviously, he's been quite critical over the years, and they want to bring him on as a consultant, but not everyone is happy about that. So, there is that in the Irish Daily Mail. The Irish Daily Star, we were talking earlier about, obviously, Kieran Cunningham's piece with Joe Brodie. That's on the inside, but on the back as well, try your best. Great headline there, as he Mick urges Parrott to earn his place against Denmark. And at the top is Klopp wants a clean break. Jurgen Klopp is praying that none of his Liverpool stars are injured during the international break, and I'd say so are all of Liverpool fans.
No, it's like the most non-story of all time. Yeah. Mick's blue-eyed Troy is the front page headline in the Star. So is it, did they decide that this week we're going to do puns on his first name and next week we're going to do puns on his second name, or pre-matches?
Oh, on the inside, Troy Wonder.
There you go. It's, just, it's like...
And Mick's dream team. That's not a pun on the name. O'Hara distributed breach. Jack's the lad to pick a pass for boys in green. So we've got to use that as well.
That's the piece, yeah, where he's saying he's the new Wes.
Yeah, and then we turn the pages. Sterling's strop with Southgate. And then the Joe Brodie piece we said about Mayo. There is a flawed culture in Mayo. This is the piece written by Kieran Cunningham. And we were just going through it in the office there this morning. And it's Joe Brodie. So obviously there's quote after quote. With some of the ones to pick out.
He's playing the hits, in fairness.
He is. He really is. And look, isn't it working? What are we talking about?
Well, yeah. I mean, I would kind of... I disagree with him on a bunch of this. Ultimately, he's come to the conclusion that Kennelly and Holmes were the saviours of Mayo football.
Yes, he has.
On the basis, it seems, of climbing Kirkpatrick with one of them. Like, he spent a bit of time in their company. There's a bit of Stockholm syndrome going on, it seems to me, where he's become mates with one of them, and it's like, ah, Jesus, you lads were knifed in the back by the celebrity losers. So it fits the narrative.
It does.
Now, I mean, like, there's a couple of frees that if they go over, there's a few refereeing decisions that if they go the wrong way, that Mayo team won All-Ireland. And you can't say that they didn't win it because the culture was flawed, because the culture got to the point where they were in a winning situation. Like...
And I know. I agree with you.
The argument that he's going to make to that is like, well, they didn't win it, so come back to me when you've won it. But ultimately, I think that that's...
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. Like, they didn't win it, and this is all opinion-based. But Joe Brodie is, like you said, using selective memory to back up his opinion with his facts. But I think there's just a few interesting things. Like, you get all this Twitter false raid stuff about things that you might write about a team, said Brodie. For example, the Mayo ones, some of them were angry about what I wrote after they lost to the Dubs in the All-Ireland semi-final. But the truth is the truth. The truth is, now this is his version of the truth, I'm sure lots of people wouldn't agree with this, is that a group of Mayo players conspired, and it was a huge shock in Mayo at the time against two of their own, Pat Holmes and Noel Kennelly. That was after a marvellous campaign in 2016, where they should have won the drawn final with Dublin and lost the replay two Titanic games in Croke Park. Noel and Pat tried to change the culture of the group for one of entitlement and individuality. Kieran Whelan actually said something relevant to this on the Sunday game during the summer, and that's his knife in, and then he twists it later in the article, talking about Donegal. And because Donegal's culture was different, they were serious about this SH1T. This is who we are. This is an expression of ourselves. And we don't give an F about All-Stars. Don't give an F who is Player of the Year or who has an effing Audi.
I mean, is there a picture of Aidan O'Shea who he's clearly aiming that at?
There is a picture of Lee Keegan, who I'm not sure what he drives. And... culture is so important. When we won the All-Ireland, that one All-Ireland in 1993, the training games were effing ferocious. There was no place for second best.
And what was wrong with the culture every other year?
Well, this is it. There was no desire for second best. Nobody's feeling sorry for themselves. Nobody was thinking of anything else but let's get this done. I'm not sure it can be fair that we can say that any Mayo player feels sorry for themselves. I don't know.
And if they did, after the decade they've had, I can see...
You can understand why they'd have a low day.
Look, I mean, probably said they didn't have enough good men. That was it. They have enough good players, but not enough good men after the semi-final. So that must be what he's talking
what
about.
What's he insinuating by that?
I don't
character?
Know. Character? Exactly. Oh, it's 100% character. Yes. Sorry, yes. And that's been the fairly consistent theme of his pieces about Mayo over the last while.
But you see, like, you're making that kind of argument and you're not in there, you're not in the camp, you don't know what the characters are, you don't know what they're like. He probably hasn't done a character psychological assessment on each and every one of them, I'd imagine, Joe Brawley. If he has, please let us know. But, like, yes, absolutely, there are questions in Mayo, as we were discussing earlier, serious questions about how county boards work and how such supporters organisations operate. That's fine, but that's not the team's fault. It's not James Horan's fault. At the same time, I do think sometimes psychologically that kind of stuff can seep into your psyche and it can get into your DNA and you have to work very, very hard to...
With the shit show that the county board is might have an impact. There is a contagion element of it.
Absolutely, it's emotional contagion.
I think that's
like,
probably true.
Think about it. You go into the shop, somebody's asking you. You go to a game, somebody's asking you. You people make jokes. You might stop off in a spar to buy a burrito. Oh, is that because the county board aren't buying your meals? Do you know, it's constant and that does seep into your head. And put on top of that, years and years and years of being told, actually, you're not going to win the All-Ireland anyway.
He's very interesting about the strength of character that Pat Kilroy was and how he was the pivotal character in the turnaround in Dublin's fortunes. Eugene McGee had talked about Dublin being Hollywood footballers at the start of the last decade. That was basically the Kieran Whelan team. And that it required Pat Kilroy to come in and weed out a few bad influences and also just make players stop being individual. Now, this is all fact, right? So this is all true. And when you look back at the career of Bernard Brogan, for example, I think Alan Brogan has told the story about Bernard losing it one night at training with Pat Kilroy and Pat Kilroy losing it back at him about not tackling back. And this is kind of a turning point. After that, Bernard becomes one of the hardest working, most aggressive defenders on the team when the team are out of possession or when there's a turnover. So that's the sort of thing I think that he might be talking about, that maybe, but like that's suggesting Andy Moran is not working as hard as Bernard Brogan did. And I find that hard to believe, you know?
As well as that. And like, that's just because Dublin managed to win. If they hadn't won, what would the narrative be?
Well, I mean, if Dublin had not...
If they'd been the Mayo of the noughties and the teens, it'd be, you know, Gilroy didn't do enough.
Yeah.
Jim Gavin hasn't built.
I guess, in fairness, although Dublin never got as close to this Mayo team, Dublin in the noughties were a team of celebrity losers. I think you could definitely...
Absolutely, yeah.
This team in Mayo, like, actually got way closer than that Dublin team did. I think it's just a little bit too easy to paint them as celebrity losers. I think there's a much more nuanced story that happens in sport where a team comes up against the greatest team of all time and can't beat them. Like, and that drives the rivalry in many respects and actually drove Dublin on. And that, I think, is worth praising Mayo for. And I'm not saying that Mayo don't have any problems, but I don't think they're the celebrity losers that they're painted here.
Like, I've always maintained that Mayo are the most consistent team ever. They're like Arsenal. As in, they're always there or thereabouts. You know, when you...
Twist the knife again.
Well, when you consider, you know, compare their resources to what Dublin has, compare the mileage they have to do, compare the travel the players have to do, compare the money, the skills, all that kind of stuff, where they're positioned in Ireland, and yet they're always there or thereabouts. Dublin really, okay, five in a row, but still a flash in the pan, so to speak, compared to Mayo's history. And they're still there or thereabouts despite everything that goes against them, despite this inter-county turmoil, despite every single winter. What are we talking about? We're talking about Mayo, why they haven't won. However, and like you said as well, this is part of the problem. This narrative is much deeper. But when we don't get access to the narrative, it's very different to paint a different narrative. And this comes back to lots of different county boards and GAA teams in particular. Their attitude is very like the Queen. It's, you know, never complain, never explain. But maybe if they explained a bit more, we might have a bit deeper understanding, and perhaps bits of copy like this about the flawed culture might perhaps have less air to go on.
Well, it's more difficult to write those pieces if you actually are out explaining things and saying things.
But yet, for some reason, this is not seeping through. And I know anybody watching or listening to this is going to say, of course she's going to say that, she's a journalist. But you know what? If a manager comes out and just talks to people and explains how things are, players, it tends to shut up any kind of vacuums that are... Because, you know, nature abhors a vacuum.
Yeah, it's interesting too how impactful the stuff that gets written is on players and managers and coaches. Listen to Warren Gatland talk last night. He was obsessive for a period of time about the stuff that was being written. And also then, while he's saying that now he doesn't do that much in terms of mind games, he was clearly heavily tuned into the power of them. And even at the end, he was like, oh, it doesn't mean that much, but I know that if I tell my players through the media that once we beat France, we're going to win the whole thing, they're listening to that. And it got in Johnny Sexton's head, was what Gatland seemed to think. And then he said, oh, and Johnny didn't have that good a game against us in the last game of the Six Nations. And I'm like, did Johnny Sexton really not have a good game against you because you said something in the media? I can't believe that. I really can't. But they're obsessed with it. And so if that's the case, come out and talk. Manage that narrative.
Yeah, exactly.
Be out ahead of it.
This is what I don't understand. Like, if they genuinely believe, okay, you have two schools of thought, zero influence whatsoever, and like you said, they're obsessive about it. So if you genuinely believe that, why aren't you out there controlling it? Why aren't you ringing up media all the time? Why aren't you wheeling people out, getting your version of the story out there?
Yeah, I'm not angry about what you've written. I just want to correct a little thing.
Yeah.
You know,
or let's talk about this instead. This is a great little angle here. I just don't understand why they don't do that more. And then when they say, and like when they say we're not paying attention, but yet, you know, you'll get a snide remark from people. You know, so they say, oh, I don't listen to the radio, I don't read the papers, and then you get, by the way, I didn't like the tone of that interview.
I didn't hear this. Somebody reported back to me.
Yeah, I heard from somebody else.
That's my favourite one. Yeah. 7:58 this morning. I'll tell you what's in the front of the Examiner. Brave and faithful, battling Blaindall overcomes injury woe to ease Munster's crisis. Tyler Blaindall has had a horrific time with injuries, basically since he arrived, but he's getting his chance this weekend, and I really hope he grabs it with both arms. He's somebody who has done some media, and there's the two-page spread inside where, you know, it's all about him. Stubborn Blaindall continues to put neck on the line. Obviously, he had a fairly bad neck injury. I really hope it works out for him because he looks like a really good player when he's confident, and he's, you know, very, very young still in terms of his career, and who knows, could be the Ireland out half of the future.
Yeah, who knows? I have the Herald here, and again, we're back to puns. Troy, you're best, says Mick. McCarthy says Parrott debut goals will put him in frame for Denmark. And also, Keane Tracy has an article at the bottom. Sexton's Leinster return. Johnny Sexton set to return to Leinster starting 15 for Saturday's Champions Cup opener against Benetton at the RDS. So Leinster fans be happy to see Sexton back, hoping that the ghosts of the World Cup are gone.
Southgate, I will recall Sterling for next game. So Gareth Southgate admits that Raheem Sterling, not his biggest fan at the moment, but says he did the right thing. And Rafa's redemption, world number one, comes back from the brink of early exit at ATP Finals. 5-1 down against Medvedev. He came back. That's the same picture in the back of the Guardian there this morning as well. And Southgate admits Sterling is unhappy, but will face Kosovo.
We have the Irish Times here, and their sports pages are in the middle today, so it's a bit more difficult to carry out. We've Jason Smith there again, continues remarkable gold run and world medal run in Dubai. Salazar makes a part apology for callous comments, which I thought was very interesting. So Alberto Salazar has issued a part apology, interesting way of putting it, for any callous or insensitive comments that he made about the weight of former teen prodigy Mary Kane and other female Nike Oregon Project athletes he coached.
Right,
which
that's
of course,
perfect.
Yeah, so, that's sort of everything.
Yeah.
It's not even a full apology, it's a part apology.
Sure, come on back. We don't care that you were using testosterone on your own coaches to see exactly what impact and how long it lasted in the body.
And staying stateside, NFL invite Kaepernick to work out for clubs to evaluate him. So this weekend could represent his best and perhaps last opportunity to play again. He's, of course, the quarterback of nearly 3 years. He struggled to resume his career after kneeling during the US national anthem. Because the worst thing you could do is kneel during an anthem for a country that doesn't respect you.
I know, it's the freedom of speech thing in America is like, oh, I've got freedom of speech to say whatever I want. But that guy over there does not have freedom of speech to say what he wants because, well, he's black, let's face it.
And doesn't agree with what I think.
That's the subtext of that. There's some interesting things about that. The NFL announced that this was happening and then told Kaepernick that it was happening. So it wasn't in conjunction, like, when would you be ready to go? When's your fitness most likely to be at its absolute best? They were like, it's this Saturday. And a bunch of teams didn't know about it in advance, so don't actually have any staff available the day before a game to fly. So if you're on the West Coast or if you're on the East Coast, Atlanta, I mean, the East Coast probably not that bad, but if you're on the West Coast, quite the distance to fly to Atlanta to send somebody who is smart enough and intelligent enough to be able to discern what they're seeing, but that they're all working on the games on Sunday. So they've clearly put this in now with not that long left in the season to go, and you know, we gave you a chance, buddy. You had your chance. You
blew it.
Exactly. So we'll see what happens.
You carry on kneeling.
I'd say there's a few, loads of teams would benefit from having Colin Kaepernick at quarterback or at least as a backup at the moment. The Racing Post, Mullins Chacon can end my wait for a champion chase. And Duvan returns today, so Close Upton had an open day. And there's stories in across the papers today in the Examiner and the Racing Post about how Willie Mullins' stable stars are going to get on this year and maybe some other horses to watch as well. So that piece by David Jennings is the lead on the Racing Post. And then Smullen, the toast of Cartier Awards. So Pat Smullen alongside Frankie Dettori. Frankie with the glass of champagne. Pat Smullen, it looks like, on the water, but looking well as well. So we wish him all the best for that.
The Times, I have upset Sterling, says Southgate. Obviously, that would be the big news across the water.
So you obviously, sports psychologist, do you think it's a sign of weakness or a sign of strength to admit that you've pissed off your star player?
I would say a sign of strength. I think Southgate has done the exact right thing there. He has forced Sterling's hand. Sterling's had to apologise. He has to go back to helping the legs, reassess himself, his behaviour. And then, you know what, when he's done that and they feel he's contrite, he's allowed back in. They're not holding it against him. They're like, you're not doing it tonight, buddy.
He hasn't been that contrite, Raheem.
He's probably more contrite than he would have been under other managers.
His Instagram post was like, oh yeah, no big deal. We move forward, we put it behind us, we had words, it's over now. You only got the guy in a headlock. Apparently, yeah. Scratched his face with the jewellery. Not that contrite. Like, I'd be like, oh look, sorry, I was out of line. Wouldn't that be contrition?
But perhaps now, for Sterling, this is very much contrition.
Now he's... Sterling's... Look, I'm a big fan of Raheem Sterling, so I think that they should do whatever they can to get in the team. But I do also think that Nathan was worried yesterday that, you know, footballers, especially the best footballers in the world, like to think that they are the big dog. And if you don't somehow pander to that ego along
not
the way...
Let's go back to Mayo again, will we? Pandering to ego. No, you cannot pander to anyone's ego. That is ridiculous. If you've got an ego, if you are in a team sport, you cannot have an ego. End of. It won't work.
Exhibit A, I give you Cristiano Ronaldo.
Who's saying they're happy around him? And who's saying...
All his Real Madrid teammates who won 3 Champions Leagues when they weren't one of the best teams
saying,
in Europe.
Are we saying they don't also have an ego? They might be feeding off his ego.
Perhaps, but so then you can't have an ego in team sports, and particularly...
You can have a managed ego, you can't pander to it. Who's saying they pander to his ego?
I think everybody panders to Cristiano Ronaldo's ego. Now, this might be the outlier. Like, from a football perspective, and we're talking exclusively in football terms, I think that if you've got a player like Ronaldo and you want to get the very best out of him, you just need to build a team around him. And so with Sterling, who's clearly their best player...
Building a team around you is very different to pandering to an ego, though.
Sure. Okay, so you think the right thing is done at this stage?
Absolutely, absolutely. Because can you imagine that kind of bad feeling that would hang around that camp if they saw that kind of behaviour and that it was excused and allowed?
Yeah.
How often have we seen England teams crash and burn because of bad behaviour?
And the cliques and the egos.
Yes.
Yeah. So look, we'll see what happens in the long term. Maybe Sterling comes out of this the other side and 2 months' time goes, yeah, look, I was wrong. I've driven up to Liverpool to meet Joe and I've said, I'm sorry, I shouldn't have done that. Because that would be growth, right?
It would. I don't know how much growth you're expecting at the same time.
You're not holding out hope.
No. And he's actually on the back page of the Mirror as well. Raheem's got hump with me. I will try my best. And Westwood fears it's all over. Kieran Westwood fears he's being retired from international duty. The Sheffield Wednesday goalkeeper insists he will never quit Ireland, even if he's not being picked. That's kind of sad. in a nice way sad. It shows what it means to him.
It's funny how no managers ever really gave Kieran Westwood the opportunity.
21 caps, apparently.
Maybe his talent deserved. No kind of significant impact.
Yeah.
Anything, last one?
And the last one, I have The Sun, and we have
Slick as a Parrot is our front page.
And Destroy, I thought was great. That's really, really good. Seek and Destroy. Mick, do the business tonight, and Kid might repeat like a parrot.
Right, there
boom,
you go.
Boom, boom.
It's 8:05 this morning. You're watching OTB AM. If you miss anything this morning, you can listen back on our podcast straight after the show. You can get it wherever you get your podcast. The best place is offtheball.com/podcast, or you can search for OTB AM in the Go Loud app. We're also, of course, on Spotify and iTunes, wherever else you get it. The podcast is timestamped as well on Spotify. You'll be able to click through to whatever you want in the two-hour show every morning. After this break, we're going to bring you Warren Gatland talking about his concerns that one of the Welsh players could have been doping, and we're also looking ahead to the Champions Cup with Rory O'Connor.
OTB AM on OTB Sports Radio, Ireland's first and only sports radio station.
They spoke about your arm not being down beside your side. I mean, this is not Irish dancing.
OTB Sports Radio.
Basketball would have been my main game.
The brand new sports radio station from Off the Ball.
That's my point. Don't play for us if you're a proud Englishman.
Now broadcasting 24 hours a day, live on the Go Loud app, Alexa.
You have a whole new world of possibilities.
Google Home, TuneIn, and offtheball.com/radio.
This is OTB Sports Radio. OTB AM.
The sad thing about professional sport, and whether it's team sport or individual sport, and when money's involved, there's that potential for it to be exploited with performance enhancing drugs. And the idea, I think, we all want it to stay as clean as we possibly can. You know, I haven't come across personally any players that I've coached that, from a Wales perspective, that I would... Sorry, maybe one. but
that you had a suspicion over?
Yeah, maybe one. Yeah, now that I think about it, but...
And did he play for Wales?
He may have done, yeah. So, okay. Yeah.
And did you have any misgivings about working with him?
No, I'm not saying that. I wouldn't...
It's a suspicion, you're saying?
Yeah.
A doubt?
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. And that's just kind of like... and that's the whole time I've been coaching Wales. But I'd like to think that the sport is clean, and from a New Zealand perspective, I think it's pretty clean. But when you go sort of down levels,
it's certainly happening there. We're seeing the positives at the lower levels.
Seeing positives in Wales as well at junior levels and other nations as well. So yeah, there's always that temptation and players wanting to, you know, try and play at a higher level and taking the risk by taking drugs. And, you know, I definitely don't condone that. And it's probably unfair of me to sort of say that, you know, I had the suspicions about one, because I've got no evidence or anything like that. It's kind of like just saying, you know, is there a possibility? So,
And would you have felt it was your role to ask that person or confront that person?
No, I just don't. It was kind of like, it was more like a couple of people making jokes sort of thing, and you go, oh, you know, so is that kind of...
truth and humour.
Yeah, exactly.
Rory O'Connor, good morning to you.
Morning, Jack.
That's pretty remarkable, isn't it?
Very interesting, very interesting. I mean... he starts. I don't know. It's interesting watching it because I'd only listened to it before. Like, he kind of says it and then realizes what he said and then kind of skates around it for a little while and then hopes Joe moves on, and Joe keeps him there a little bit longer than he probably would like. Because it's a big admission. Although he says, you know, there's no facts behind it, but he had one player that he picked that he suspected of doping. I don't know what you do in that case. Like, do you, I think you said off earlier, like, do you bring in testers, just specifically look at that person? Do you raise red flags yourself?
Yeah.
Is that what you're supposed to do
as an athlete? Yes.
Or do you go out and win the game? Because this guy's clean as far as I'm aware. And what does the coach do? What does the man who's paid to win the matches do? And that is probably the ethical question that hangs over many sports. If WADA or...
And so we know whatever, what the right answer is, but we know what the real politic of... professional sport is, that you aren't paid to be the moral arbiter, you are paid to win games.
Yeah.
And that's why this happens.
Yeah.
Because if everybody was just doing the right thing, it wouldn't happen.
And if individuals go off and do it themselves and are not ordered as part of some sort of system, you know, we do hear people say there's no systematic problem in rugby, but players are sent away at academy level, at senior level, you know, they get into a national team squad and they're told, come back bigger. What does that message really mean?
Yeah.
It's like, you know, is it more protein shakes or is there quicker, easier ways of
chicken
doing
fillets?
That?
I mean, of course, there's 12 chicken fillets for breakfast and 12 for tea.
Yeah, absolutely. So, no, like, it's good that he said it. You know, it's good that he put it out there. I mean, I don't think he kind of didn't follow through on it, but, you know, it's out there now. He also, you know, spoke about South Africa a little bit and the fact that he had, you know, that he understands why people, I think that's what he said, he understands why people would have suspicions, although he said Neil Francis's piece was a little bit too strong, I think. So it's kind of bubbling away there beneath the surface. At the World Cup, no one really wanted to talk about it at South Africa, apart from the Irish journalists.
Just, you know, it was kind of a... Yeah, which
why was that? Or do you know?
I don't really know. Like, I mean, you do sometimes get carried away by the sport itself and what's happening in front of you and the matches and it is a regular cycle, and it was kind of more at the start of the tournament when it was
before the game
still
started.
In preview mode. Yeah. You know, once the game starts, and there is, I mean, Gatland even said, you know, you don't want to be seen to be taken away from their success, you know, that you don't want to take the gloss away from their medals. So
check
at what
your
point,
Twitter feed when that happens.
At what point do you make the accusation? You know, is it 10 years' time when it doesn't matter? Like, you
exactly.
know,
no, we have to have these conversations now.
Yeah.
But it's really interesting, I think, just to go back to this, that I don't think Gatland handled that situation properly. I don't think that any coach, if you have a suspicion, even if the lads in training are joking about somebody, then because it's so serious, you have to go and say, there's this joke out there, you need to address it. Because if it's true, then you can't ever play for us again. And if it's not true, then your character is being slandered.
So what do? You bring the player in, you ask them.
No, you also you do multiple things. Yeah.
So you bring them in and you go, like, you know, do I have a reason to be suspicious against you?
And you also get the testers to target test this person. Mm. We hear all the time about players being target tested in all of the nations that play professional rugby.
I would imagine if the jokes are about that player, and I mean,
maybe he's already being target tested.
You'd imagine so. And you'd imagine that's probably one of the sources of the jokes. I mean, there's certain players within the Irish setup
that I'd be very naive now if you think that if there's jokes that they're going to target test. If anything, I would argue
jokes come on the basis of target testing.
There are players.
You know what I mean? So there are players already getting target tested.
Players know who's been tested after every game. I mean, there's certain Irish players get pulled after every game. You know, there's a routine to this. So the players know it, and that would feed into
it. It's a bit late to be testing them after the game. As in,
of course. Well, I mean,
testing is happening completely at the wrong time for these target tests.
They are tested out of competition as well, and they're tested. You know, there are random. You know, I think Leinster would, routinely get random process. But like, look, I think you're right. Ethically, you should have been ringing UK
anti-doping,
and they should be ringing him today on the basis of this and going, hang on, who's this guy?
Yeah.
Why did you pick him? Is he still playing?
Yeah.
The other thing he says, and it's a trope that we hear all the time, and it is the facts are that people at lower levels dope, but like, why are they doping, and why do they suddenly stop when they get to the top level? You know, why does that stop at the elite level? Like, are they just bad at doping? Like, you know, are they bad at doping as well as being bad at rugby? Like,
let's take, for example, a sport where doping has been rampant for decades. Did the best cyclist of all time continue to dope when he was the best cyclist of all time, and did it make him a better cyclist as opposed to him going, well, I've already made it now, so I don't need to dope? Yes, he'd continue to dope is the answer like, to my rhetorical question.
I mean, does Gerben Grobler continue to get the benefits of the thing that he did, what was it, 4 or 5 years ago? Did, like, have the benefits of that program that he was on that he got caught for? Is that still aiding him to become a top level professional at Gloucester?
According to the research, it was.
I'd say,
I mean, that's one of the big problems that, you know, we discussed in here a lot, you know, a couple of years ago when that was the burning issue of the day. So yeah, are they doing it coming up? Is it in school? I mean, the one thing South Africa do well that we don't do is they test in schools. I mean, we can hold up Craven Week as an example, but at least they test their school kids, whereas in Ireland we don't. So, but look, I think Gatland, it's good that he shone a light on it. It's bad that he shied away from it. I think there is follow-up. And Joe tried to follow up, and he kind of, you could see him almost backing away. He wanted to move on a little bit. It was a really good interview. I think the UK anti-doping will have follow up for them if they get their hands on this.
Yeah, totally. And we'll certainly be following up with them as well. I want to talk about Bundiaki, because obviously this has been bubbling away now for the last week. So I think, was it yourself or Keane had this story first?
No, I had Marmion.
Okay, right.
Yeah. I'm not going to claim it.
Okay, fair enough. Maybe it was Gavin. Sorry, one of Gavin Comiskey.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
And now I'm in trouble with everybody.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I'm not going to claim it anyway. I'm not going to. People get annoyed about this stuff. Like, people are always going to be interested in Bunyaki. His contract's up and he's a good player. So people get annoyed with us. If he signs on McConnell, people are like, yeah, we're wrong. And it's like, no, of course there's interest. Of course Saracens and player teams of that caliber are after Kieran Marmion. I mean, that's just a sign that Connacht and Bundyaki are doing good things. Is he on a national contract? I don't think he is. I think he's due one.
Bundy.
So,
why would he not be on a national contract? I'm
racking my brains. Maybe he is. He wouldn't have been. It was 2 years ago when he qualified. I need to check that. But it would be the Irish if you were doing negotiations with Bundyaki, I would imagine. He has been pretty much never present in the Irish team. His age is possibly working against him to a degree, because he's 29, I think, now. And we are supposed to be moving on to a new era and all that sort of thing. But if you're a fellow who pitches up every week and performs, and you're the kind of anchor of a midfield,
Is 33-year-old Bundyaki significantly different from 29-year-old Bundyaki?
You just got to get to the line story. Like, the first 2 years are the kind of pivot point, and then, you know, you kind of manage players through. You don't just throw out all your older players now, I don't think. So I think that Nusavora will be aware that there's interest. It will drive up his price. It's convenient for Bundy's agent that it's out there. And he may go or he may stay. I mean, I feel like he's done his bit with Ireland and it's time to get the payload, you know?
Yeah, and if he goes, we're obviously not picking him ever again. Is that how that works? Is that they're the rules? And those rules and no sign of any change to those rules?
That's the way it works, yeah. Yeah, I mean, I particularly don't know if you'd change the rules for a player who's not from Ireland, personally. I mean, that would, especially when you don't pick Zeebo for as long as you don't. I mean, maybe Andy Farrell comes in and changes that. Maybe he says, look, I need these guys that, you know, maybe Dunacron's a bad example because he's probably a little bit past his best, but, you know, that I can go and get Zeebo because he's the most creative back we've produced in the last 10 years.
Yeah.
I mean, that is a conversation Andy Farrell needs to have.
Is there not a part of this that we're cutting our nose off to spite our face? If Bundyaki goes and plays for one of the French teams and gets paid $500,000, they're literally paying his wages and we get to have him for free.
Mm. Yeah, but then...
Is there not part of that where we're like, that's not the worst deal I've ever heard?
Yeah, but then Connacht are weakened. Connacht's capacity to go out...
But you've saved 500 grand, so you can go and sign
get the
three.
Next one. Yeah, well, that's a fair point, but the argument is that once he goes and he starts... And
the floodgates open.
I don't particularly, you know, I don't think that the interest is there. Like, I mean, the Irish players didn't exactly tear up trees at the World Cup. I don't know how many French clubs are going to be beating down the door for all of our top guys right now.
And it turns out we've loads of strength and depth. We've loads of players at roughly the same level.
Yeah.
Like, we thought we had a bunch of players who were absolutely elite world-class players, and we were wrong. It proved at the World Cup they weren't as good as we thought they were. Yeah. We have a bunch of players at the next level. Why don't we allow them to go and spread their wings and see over the next 18 months, two and a half years, do what South Africa did, send them all off around the world, get some experience and go, okay, you're all really good, you guys not so good. Yeah, you're
predicting,
coming.
Predicting this first 2 years of the cycle, you almost go to them, look, go, do what New Zealand are doing, go to Japan, go make your money, you know, go, like, you know, and put the doors open for you to come back, you know, Conor Murray, go to Japan for a year, take, like, you know, play, it's a faster game, but they're smaller, like smaller players, it's less intense.
Yeah.
Go get yourself fit, go enjoy yourself for a year, see a bit of the world and bring you back into the Munster fold then. Now, Munster fans will say, we want to win the Heineken Cup this year. And Connacht would be massively dented by Bundyaki.
Absolutely.
He is almost a spiritual leader in that squad. Like, you could see, even when he came on, he only came on for a minute and came off because of an injury last weekend, but the lift the sports ground got, even though the game was already gone. I think he's not their captain, but he's a very important player in Connacht. And I think it would send a really bad message if the RFU let him go.
Yeah.
So I do think for all the people don't like the project players playing for Ireland, some people don't, some people do. Bundyaki for Connacht became more Connacht than
Connacht itself. Like,
absolutely.
Even because when I arrived at the game last week, I just got there, just the team was coming out and obviously they were getting their cheer from the kids outside. But when Bundy was the last one walking out and kids were going nuts for him, and you realise that's because Bundy has been to every single school in Connacht. Every child feels like he's their friend. You take that away, where's the star then? I don't know, do Connacht have another star like Bundy? No way.
Not on that level. But I mean, Bundy, he's already made a massive decision based on finance in moving to Ireland in the first place. You know, I mean, the lure of playing international rugby was part of it, but he could have done that for Samoa and maybe even if he stayed, played for New Zealand. But, you know, the RFU came in with a significant offer to come and play for Ireland, play for Connacht. And like many before him, he came over and did it. And if say, Claremont or Racing 92 are offering him a significant package in the way that, you know, Ireland were blown out of the water by, you know, for the Zeebo one, If Ireland have been blown out of the water, like, do you match that for a 29-year-old? I mean, Nusafora has, I can't remember her name, but he has basically a statistician or an analytics person who basically does the numbers on the player's value. I would say Bundy's value is pretty high because he pitches up so often. So they'll probably come at him with a decent contract. But whether an RFU decent contract can match what the French are offering is an interesting one.
Yeah.
And if he goes, I think
that does, then we should be having this conversation as opposed to it just being us having this conversation. The conversation should be had about allowing everybody to go off for a couple of years and see what happens. Because we've tried it with everybody, every minute managed, every training session managed, every load, every piece of nutrition managed for 4 years, and it didn't work. It didn't give us what we needed in the end.
Yeah.
So let's try something different.
Yeah, I think just play more, you know, like stop managing them as much, you know, but, you know, bring back the interpros. You know, like it doesn't seem to bother the English or South African players. I think the Irish players were overprotected, but I do think that weakening, I think Leinster, you know, like Leinster fans won't like this, but like Leinster can afford to lose a few. Connor can't afford to lose Bunyaki. I know you can go to the market, but you can't necessarily get the same match.
No, it's
Galway's a difficult place for a player to come from overseas. I mean, I was down there yesterday, it was miserable. You know, like players, there have been a lot of players who haven't settled in Galway, and particularly from the islands. You know, they could have had Sevi Reese down there as well at the moment. He could have been the Bundyaki of the future if it wasn't for his own behaviour. So,
kind of reminds me a bit of how Niall Quinn used to describe trying to get players to move to Sunderland.
Yeah.
Like, it wants to be a pretty good deal. Because Galway's lovely, but if you're not
It's not even the city. I don't want to, I'm going to anger people. The sports ground facilities are terrible.
Oh, stop.
And until the redevelopment happens, I mean, Bundy's already come out and given out about them. He went back after Ireland training and kind of went, look at this pitch, you know, I'm back here in this muck and rain, and the pictures of him jumping over big puddles. And I mean, it's part of the rustic charm that, you know, that appeals to us probably romantically, but when you're there on a daily basis, you know, until that redevelopment happens, it's like they're way below what the other provinces can offer in terms of training facilities.
But unless they keep hold of the Bundys and stuff, that's not going to happen. So
Absolutely.
You can see how it's so difficult for them.
It's double-edged sword, I think. Like, you know, there are two sides. And I think it's a discussion worth having about whether the RFU loosen that ruling and let the players go off and earn the big money and continue to pick
them for a couple of years.
And also, and why don't you use London Irish? Make a deal with Declan Kidney.
Ah, here, you know, the London Irish thing. They should buy London Irish. They should put together a consortium.
An Irish businessman with loads of money.
But it would be no harm having one of the shares in the Premiership and just knowing exactly what's happening in those rooms.
I interviewed Kidney before the start of the season and he said, I don't know if he said he'd never spoken to David Nusafora, but he said that conversation has not happened. That there was a bit of a burning of the bridges during previous regimes and the relations weren't great. God, that's a no-brainer for Nusafora to pick up the phone.
I've heard the RFU have burned bridges all over the place, to be honest.
Like, yeah.
There was a debate on Friday in here about whether or not Bundyaki owed it to Ireland and owed it to Connacht to stay. As a Connacht supporter, what do you think?
I wouldn't agree with that at all. It's his career. He owes it to himself and his family to do what's right for him. And if you're a believer in people and a believer in how people progress, and if you're grateful for what Bundy has brought to Connacht, if he's decided his time is done. That's like the argument people make, oh, you've studied medicine in Ireland for 10 years, of course, I would say this, you better stay here and suffer in the HSE for 10 years, pay us back for the taxes we paid to put you through college. Like, life doesn't work that way. You know, like, that's ridiculous. Connacht has given him great things, but I think he has given Connacht more than Connacht has given him.
You can't cynically exploit the rules and then get upset when the player then cynically exposed, the reason Bunyaki had never been to Connacht before he signed, he's bought into it brilliantly since he got here, but initially it was the carrot of a cap and a very good contract.
He had to wait three years.
Glasgow tried to sign him.
Right, and he had to wait 3 years for the cap. So while he was doing that, he was showing up every week and doing his job.
He helped turn Connacht into a force.
Exactly. And doing it well, and doing it in the rain.
No, you can't have both sides, but like, you gotta let the guy go and do what's best for his career.
Instead of looking at that, exactly, let them off, go out overseas, let them get their experience, and then take, jeepers, if the French are throwing money at them and they're keeping them happy and building them up and keeping them strong and giving them skills, absolutely do it and take it back as your green jersey on it. It's nuts.
I'm inclined to agree. Can we talk briefly about Saracens? Because the narrative coming out of Saracens is like, oh, the European Cup, we have no interest in that whatsoever. But like,
not buying it.
Why does it make no sense at all?
No.
This is exactly the year they want to win the European Cup. Because like, look at all you put on our shoulders, and we're still the best team in Europe.
Absolutely, and it's a dressing room full of winners. And however they put that squad together, they are excellent players. in a winning culture, and they can't win the Premiership this year.
A really deep squad.
So the best academy in the UK, possibly.
The only thing on offer for them, like this, the 35 points deduction will get cut to something smaller. They're definitely going to stay up.
No, they're not appealing. It doesn't sound like they're going to appeal.
Okay. I still think they're going to make.
They'll still stay up. Like, but based on the points.
There's no way
total,
the Premiership can do without Saracens. They're not that dumb.
Well, they relegated. Well, not they relegated. The Harlequins got relegated and came back. It's not. I don't think the other Premiership clubs would be sad to see them go. I don't think they like them very much. I think we could safely say that based on the what's come out in the recent past.
From Exeter.
Exeter called for it. Was it Exeter? Someone called for them to be relegated. Danny Kerr, wasn't it? I think they'd be quite happy to get rid of them so they can maybe have a few days in the sun themselves. But they're the best. I was going to say they're the best running club in the country. They're obviously not because they've breached a lot of protocols. But they have put together something pretty special on the pitch and in the dressing room. Mark McCall is someone that the RFU should be looking at themselves, even though I'm not sure he'd ever come back. But, an Irish guy put this all together. And I'm
Bridges
sure
burned, you say? What?
I'm sure he's been given a budget and he's implemented it, to the best of his ability.
Yeah.
No, I don't buy it. And, I do think that they slipped off the pace 2 years ago, the year Leinster won it. And that was down to the fact that they had so many players in the Lions Tour and they came back a bit broken. And they have basically, I think, 6 players who just played in the World Cup final and lost it. And went deep into the World Cup, played pretty much the entire Rugby Championship. So that will have an effect. And whether they'll pick those players this weekend remains to be seen. And if they don't, they go to Racing and they lose and they're suddenly on the back foot.
But aren't Racing rubbish at the minute?
They're playing below themselves. Like they're still really good, but they've suspended Nakarawa because he went off and built a house for his father instead of coming back to the Racing after the World Cup. So there's all sorts of little weird storylines going on. It's actually why I kind of believe the Irish province could have a good year this year, despite the fact of what happened in Japan. So I think Saracens will take it seriously, but I think they might have to. I think a lot of the English clubs will have to reintegrate their internationals late because they only finished playing the World Cup 2 weeks ago, whereas the Irish players gave themselves a nice break.
Yeah.
Oh, that was all it's all about, wasn't it? Give yourself a nice break.
They were taking one for the provinces.
Yeah, they've all been to Dubai and back, and they're all refreshed, and now they've got a cause now. They're trying to prove us all wrong.
Yeah, Saxon did speak about being frustrated after the World Cup. At what point, he said, look, for those players who might never get a chance again, it'll always be raw. Is that just, so they're never going to move on from this?
It should always be raw. They got to the biggest point, they got their base camp, and they fell off the mountain. They didn't perform at the biggest point of their career. It should be the thing that drives them to succeed and win as many trophies as they can in the next couple of years.
Yeah, or it becomes this thing that eats you up to the point where you can't perform anymore.
Then you don't get picked. That's the new rule. You're not playing with it. Doesn't matter who you are, you don't get picked. It has to be.
From a Leinster perspective, from a Munster perspective.
Well, Leinster brought that in after 2016. I think we have seen big players left on the bench, left out of 23s. After they lost to Connacht in that final, I think the big lesson that they took that summer when they kind of had their coaches' meetings is that they didn't back the players who got them there. They kind of brought in the internationals based on their caps and their experience. And I think that, you heard what Catelyn said, two or three players looked a bit old at the World Cup. Schmidt stayed loyal to his senior men too long. And that is the big lesson I think we all have to take, that, while players, someone might be World Player of the Year last year, it doesn't mean he's necessarily going to start this year. Conor Murray can't get picked just because he's Conor Murray. If he's playing like a train in the Six Nations, Kieran Marmion's already beaten the All Blacks in England. Drop him. Maybe that's the best thing that could happen to him. Rory Best, 37-year-old captain, you can't do that. That is the lesson, I think, from the World Cup, is that you've got to go with form at all times. Larmour, Conway, Ruddock, Porter, Kilcoyne, we're all playing better than the players who started.
But isn't it shocking, though, and maybe forgive my complete ignorance here and complete ignorance and stupidity, but surely that's coaching 101. You play the best player. My mind is blown by the fact that, the way you've just explained that, and you said, but sure, I'll throw best in anyway.
Well,
do you know?
It's possibly selection 101. I think there was a theory, there's this model that people have built for World Cup winners, and it's all about caps and it's all about experience, and you kind of build these groups together, and you have cohesion is one of the biggest factors. So if you've built all these units and you have this front row of played together X amount of times, you've got this 9-10 partnership. 12-13 didn't build a cohesion because there were so many injuries around Bundyaki. But the whole model was built around the fact that these players know each other, that they've played together before, they've had these experiences. Like 2015, Hansen referenced the fact that they came back against Ireland in 2013 as being a big moment on their journey to the World Cup. So the model was there that you kind of stick with these players through thick and thin. New Zealand ripped that model up this year and cast off Ben Smith. Now, maybe it cost him against England, but against Ireland, they looked so vibrant.
Could you make the argument then, if that was the case, if you were sticking to that model, why wasn't Devin Toner there?
You could, yeah, you could, absolutely. I mean, these are the questions that we would love to ask Josh Smith, but we won't. Maybe the book will tell us.
When's that book out?
Next week.
Next week, yeah.
Next week, yeah. I don't think he will, but yeah, look, I think this is the thing. We all think that Schmidt managed the 3 years of the World Cup cycle so well. He ticked nearly every box. He won every game that he, you know, he had all these firsts and highs along the way. You know, built all these cohesion. You know, all the profile was really good, and then it fell off a cliff. And suddenly, the model is doesn't.
One thing that I haven't had a chance to talk to anybody about this yet, but David Nusafour is overseeing the investigation, the inquest into the whole thing. That doesn't make any sense to me because he's actually a central character in it.
It's he was there. He was an accredited member of the management.
It's like it's like the FAI investigating themselves. Like. Mm. That's not what happened when...
The FAI could share one of the auditors, couldn't they?
Absolutely. When you go back and read Legacy... now, look, a lot of that turns out to be nonsense, right? It's the... We get to write history because we won eventually. But eventually, it took them a long time to get there despite the fact they had the best team in the world. Talking about the All Blacks book, Legacy. But there was a very interesting, proper, in-depth inquest into what happened, and they absolutely investigated everything that they possibly could. But it was an outside organisation that did it. It wasn't the New Zealand's...
Genesis did it in 07.
RFU doing it. And, like, is that not what you need? So someone's saying... So, David, your strategy was that nobody who left could play and explain, and now would you do the same thing again, knowing everything you know now? So there's at least a question of him, no? Because at the moment, he seems to be...
And he was handed a four-year extension just before the World Cup as well. So
even more reason to have somebody interrogate from outside and go, well, so are you going to do the same thing again?
Absolutely. Even the fact that we'll never actually see that report and that David Nusafour will bring us into a room on Christmas week, which is what has happened in the past, so everyone's at Christmas parties, no one's really paying any attention. He'll sit there with his hand on the report and he'll tell us what's in it. But none of us will ever actually get to see it and interrogate it and see what the detail in there is. And they say that's because it's IP, because you know it's what they do. And in fairness, Warren Gatland did say that their system is best in class last night, which is interesting. You know that and it's one of the failures of Schmidt is that you know everything was set up for him and he didn't deliver it at the end of the day. But I completely agree with you. I think it should be outsourced, it should be open. I think the people who travelled to Japan deserve to know what went wrong. You know, people who spent their own money. I think the fans who tune in, I think they say that, you know, it's a team of us, isn't it? That's the whole thing. We're supposed to all have a part in this. But when it comes to this, it's not. It's very much closed shop. And it's not, look, they're not transparent around loads of stuff. And they never have been.
You'd have a lot more confidence too if it was an external company. They're going to say, look, we're not going to be transparent, but we're giving this independent, external set of people carte blanche to go and we will act on it. And even then, it's still not satisfactory, but it's a hell of a lot better, like you said, than going in Christmas week with your moment is...
Yeah, well, that's what I fully expect to happen this time. They are bringing in external interviewers to interview the players. They wouldn't tell me if it would be anonymous or not. But David Nusafour manages the contracts as well.
Yeah, so
you're already going to go, well, do you know who I think is going to be involved in this? You, actually. But I'd like $500,000 a year for next year.
Yeah, so three or four lads who are on their way out, who are literally on their last contract, will have some freedom in that room. But everybody else will be like, yeah, I think everything's great. You're a man. Wow. Don't think you could have done anything better for us here, Dave. You're like, wow, you're a stand-up guy.
Yeah.
I love your work.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, but the thing, part of it is, like, he's there, Andy Farrell's there. You know, everything's already in place for the next 4 years. So, you know, unless... I suppose that they're asking us to trust them to do it right, but you know, this is an organisation that's never delivered anything but better than a quarter final in the past. So, it's a bit deflating.
Well, look, there's good games to look forward to this weekend.
Yeah, absolutely.
Saturday, Bath against Ulster, Leinster against Benetton. Leinster could not have cherry picked. I mean, Benetton are actually much better.
They are, yeah.
Yeah, they're better than Italy, is what one of the Leinster players said to us recently, off the record. But so it will be a good game. Leinster should win, should get a bonus point.
You'd expect it. I mean, if it's like what it's like this morning, it might make life a bit difficult, just weather-wise. I mean, if you're trying to score four tries, but we saw what Leinster, did to Connacht on Friday night. I mean, they're able to do it both ways. They can beat the crap out of them and get tries through mauls. Ronan Keller is a try machine at the moment, which is really exciting.
Was it your stat that he's closing in on the record, single-season record for...
No,
can you credit for everything?
I really wish I'd come up with all these things. But no, yeah, he is closing the record.
Sean Cronin and somebody else has scored 8 tries in a season. He's already got 6 or 7.
6, I think. Yeah, it's not. I mean, a lot of them are popping up at the base of malls, which is the way Hooker score tries. But he's been really good in open play as well, and I would expect him to be back this weekend. Keane has a story this morning that Doris is going to start at 8, which is pretty interesting as well. I think it might be his European debut, certainly his first start. So, like, Leinster, I think, will be fine. I think Treviso were good. I chatted Dean Keatley last night. He's going to be involved. He said they had a slow start of the season, but basically the entire Italy squad was away for the start of it, so they're kind of reintegrating them back into it. So they'll cause Leinster problems. They've won and drawn on their last two visits to the RDS against weakened Leinster teams, but Leinster's at full strength, should be good enough to beat them, but I think Treviso will make it interesting.
Okay, Bath against Ulster, big game for Ulster because this is a difficult pool for them. They've got to start getting something on the board pretty early.
Yeah, I think this is, like, if Francois Lowe and Sam Underhill are not involved, which, you know, there's a good chance they might not be because they're both, you know, just having come back after playing in a World Cup final, Bath will be a little bit weakened. I don't see Bath as contenders. I think there's a big gap between Saracens and the rest. Maybe Gloucester are quite good in Connacht's pool, but so I think Ulster will need to win one of their two away games in England and then try and get some decent return off Claremont, you know, 4 at home and 1 away maybe. That could get them through. Ulster looked okay on Saturday in Thomond Park if they could hang onto the ball.
Yeah.
Their pack was good. Jack McGrath looked like he had a bit of life about him again for the first time in a couple of years, which was good. He was getting in people's faces. He was nice and aggressive. That's good to see. Their tie five, Sam Carter, the Australian signing, looks quite good. Matt Faddy's the New Zealander in the back three, is a good addition as well. So they have
depth.
I wouldn't say depth, but they've got a 23 now, I think. You know, they're currently looking good on the injury front. Henderson comes back in, Stockdale comes back in. Two players with massive points to prove after the World Cup.
Yeah.
To themselves more than anything, because they both had bad games against New Zealand. So I think Ulster have a good chance of getting out, but it's these games against the English teams that they'll have to pick up the points because they're unlikely to top Claremont, who were my pick to win it.
Okay, and Ospreys against Munster, it's a triple header on Saturday.
Yeah.
So that's the Saturday evening kickoff. Ospreys are playing like drains at the minute.
Munster have got to get 10 points off the Ospreys as a base. Everyone in that pool will be looking at that, Saracens and Racing. Like, it's between Saracens, Racing and Munster, so you've got to pick up as much against Ospreys as your base and then try and win the battles against the other two teams. When the draw was made an issue, I thought Munster were in big trouble. But the Saracens thing and the fact that England got to the World Cup final and lost has put a dent in my confidence in Saracens at this stage of the tournament. I think if they get to the knockouts, they could still win it. And then Racing have started really poorly. But Racing have a lot of intel on Munster with Razebo, Ryan and Mike Prendergast and the coaching team as well. So that's the most interesting pool of all, I think.
Okay, the Leinster-Benetton game and the Bath-Ulster game, both live on Off the Ball on Saturday afternoon. Bath-Ulster kicks off at 1 and Leinster-Benetton kicks off at 3:15. On Sunday, it's Connacht against Montpellier. They need to win.
Yeah, it's going to be tough for them. They're missing a lot of second rows. They're missing 4 of their internationals and they don't have that many internationals as it stands. So it's going to take one of those special Connacht performances, and I think a 1 o'clock kickoff possibly works against them. But Montpellier are one of the worst away teams in the tournament. So they'll hope that Montpellier kind of come over with a kind of, you know, a bit of a bad attitude, that they can take advantage, they can move them around. Maybe it's a bit of a dirty day. But they're hoping for a few factors that, you know, that are outside their control. They are a good team, Connacht. It's unfortunate that they've, having reached this point that they wanted to reach, they've done it. They're missing O'Halloran, they're missing Beelam, they're missing Quinru, Gavin Thornbury, and one of the internationals whose names escapes me right now. They've got a good back line, but their pack is a bit lightweight. Okay. That's a concern.
All right, Rory, good stuff. Thanks for joining
Cheers.
Us. And I should just remind everybody, it was Gav Kumsky who had the Bundy Aki story, so just in case. I've given everybody the right level of credit that they deserve. Warren Gatland talking last night about some line selections. Definitely look this up. It's good stuff. There's loads of great stuff in it. The stuff about Schmidt that we talked about earlier on, the stuff about the drugs as well. Here he is talking about some of the young Irish lads who might make it for the Lions. Have a look.
I don't want to put names in your mouth, so I'll just ask you the open question. What younger Irish players who haven't played for the Lions before are impressing you? What names have you already half penciled in as very promising?
I think Lama's pretty special for footwork and stuff, and you'd like to see Joey Carberry in terms of the next few years, in terms of, I know he's a bit injury prone, but there's something pretty exciting about him.
Do you see him as a 10 or a 15?
I see him as a 10 at the moment. Okay.
Anyone else?
Ringrose, he's got something about him. I don't know about Conway. there's numerous loose forwards who can put their hand up in terms of Ryan. James Ryan was obviously.
We see Ryan as a starter. So if you drop him, they'll be held up.
Well, there's some competition in it in that second row, you know, and and the thing is, the hardest thing is about, the hardest thing about selecting a Lions side is probably not picking a squad. It's trying to get a captain, and the stronger the side is, the stronger the team is, the harder it is to pick a captain.
Because you want someone who's nailed on.
Yeah, almost nailed on.
Yeah. Great stuff from Warren Gatland talking to Joe last night. You can get that on our YouTube channel. There's about 80,000 subscribers now to our YouTube channel, so make sure you join the fun. Don't miss out. Right, how are we looking, Tom?
We're good, yeah. We're looking forward to three Republic of Ireland teams in action over the course of the day today. The seniors welcome New Zealand to Dublin for a friendly international 7:45 kickoff at the Aviva Stadium. 17-year-old Troy Parrott will become the youngest player since Robbie Keane to debut for the boys in green. And Mick McCarthy says he has a big future.
One game doesn't define, you know, I don't know too well. There might have been a few that's had one game and never played again. I may well have played some of those as well. But that's not for Troy. Troy's just a young lad who'll need the help of everybody else, and he'll get that as well in terms of what I say to him. He's got a bright future ahead of him. Let's hope he stays fit and well and he can enjoy it.
Accidental partridge there.
Yeah.
Oh, one game. Oh, there was that guy and then the little guy.
Was it like around 94? Your man, the goalie player, was it Alan Glenn, I think, off the top of my head? And he got one game in America under Jack. So, yeah, hopefully it's not going to be a similar scenario.
There was a few. There was a Mickey Evans got one game, I think, under Mick, who was going to be a striker, who was going to solve all our problems then. But
yeah.
Defender Lee O'Connor will also make his debut. Hopefully he got a big feature. That's his first senior start for any team.
Right.
It's an Ireland cap. Shades of Gordon Darcy stuff there. With Shamrock Rovers creator Jack Byrne and goalkeeper Kieran O'Hara also set for their first full debuts. McCarthy's also given starts to Robbie Brady, Kieran Clark and Seanie Maguire, who of course will be hoping to force their way into his thinking ahead of Monday's must-win game against Denmark. After losing in Iceland, the under-21s are in Yerevan to play Armenia from noon. And at the same time, the under-19s play their rescheduled match away to Switzerland in Salzburg. England will seal their place at the Euro 2020 by avoiding defeat to Montenegro at Wembley tonight. The build-up to the match obviously been dominated by the clash between Raheem Sterling and Joe Gomez. It's England's 1,000th game, so there's going to be quite a lot of pomp and ceremony ahead of this one. But
Cannons and poppies, I presume, and flyovers.
I don't know. Will they have the little kid dressed as the poppy? And that was
people. They fire him out of a cannon dressed as the poppy.
I don't know. Anyway, there are obviously plenty of issues off the pitch for manager Gareth Southgate, and he says they're just part of the job.
I don't know what a normal week with England would be, frankly. So the key is always to go and win the football matches. And that's, you know, where my focus has been for the last 48 hours and for the 3 weeks before that.
And former Arsenal manager Arsene Wenger has a new job. The Frenchman's been appointed as this is straight out of W1A. The FIFA Chief of Global Football Development. He'd been out of work since the North London club in the summer of 2018. Wenger told FIFA TV he hopes to make a real difference in the game.
Especially, I would say, in football, what is the most important is to transform your ideas into practice. And that's what I would like to do, help FIFA to develop the coaching by being really practical and efficient.
Right.
Yeah, there you go. So,
what did any of that mean?
You remember that sitcom 2012 in the run-up to, it was on the BBC?
I actually only watched like one episode of it, but apparently it was quite good.
Yeah, really good. And there's a follow-up called W1A as well, based on the same characters, and this just straight out of that. Like, anyway, on to the World Para-Athletics Championships in Dubai, and Greta Strømkitte finished fifth in the women's 1500 metres T13. Of course, two medals for Ireland already after Jason Smith got a gold yesterday in the 100 metres. In the NBA, Bit of an update, quite enough week. So the beard got the better of the claw in one of the biggest battles in the Western Conference overnight. James Harden helped himself to 47 points as the Rockets beat the Clippers there. 102-93, Rockets now second in that division behind the Lakers, who bounced back last night. LeBron James helping himself to 23 points as they piled more misery onto the Golden State Warriors, and now just 2-10. With an injury-ravaged season, and they are bottom of that conference. Well, in the Eastern Conference, Boston made it a 9-game winning streak as they beat the Wizards by 140-33, with Kemba Walker top scoring with 25.
All right, good stuff, Tom. Thanks for that. You done?
Yeah.
Nice one. Damien Delaney's up next. First, here's Mick talking about Jack Byrne, who will start tonight.
I want him to do what he does with Shamrock Rovers, which is he gets hold of the ball, he passes it, he creates chances. He keeps the ball moving, he recycles it for others and doesn't give it away. His free kicks and corners, his deliveries are good. And his penalties are excellent, having seen the one in the cup final. That was a great penalty. I want him to show that it's not Denmark by any stretch of imagination, but it's a big international game that New Zealand are treating it as a big international game. So, and for Jack it will be. And for him to showcase what he's got, because he's got lots. He has done so much better in the 12 months that I've influenced maybe a bit. TC has in his all-round game. He's got no problems with the ball and that, but off the ball he's done far better as well.
Damien Delaney is with us. Damien, good morning to you. How you doing?
Morning, Roy.
I wanted to ask a little bit about what you think Jack Byrne is going to feel tonight when he does step up. Because there's been a lot of suggestion that the League of Ireland to international football is too big a leap for anybody to make. You've understand exactly what this leap is like. You've played in the League of Ireland recently enough. So how far away is Jack Byrne from being able to play international football properly?
I think the only thing he needs is to be testing himself against better opposition more often, which he probably doesn't get in the League of Ireland. Rovers and Dundalk are the two strongest teams, and they have the vast majority of the ball. So tonight's just a great opportunity for him just to go take the game by scruff of the neck and go and enjoy himself, especially after the high of the cup final. So I'm hoping he puts in a really, really good performance.
What was your experience of the league when you were playing in it? Like, what was the standard like?
Look, the standard League of Ireland is pretty good, but the difference between what you get in the League of Ireland and what you get across the water in the Championship or even in League One now is you get a better standard week in, week out. You're testing yourself every week. You have to be in top gear to get results. And I think Shamrock Rovers, unfortunately, in the League of Ireland, there's four or five teams where they can show up in second gear and win games. And sometimes that could be a little bit easy for Jack. So his consistency is probably the only thing. And he'd only get that by testing himself against better opposition more often.
It's one of those situations maybe where the style of play that he has will work in certain leagues and for certain teams. I don't want to make the obvious Wes comparison, but it's made today in the papers. Wes was able to step up from League of Ireland to go and play in Scotland, to go and play in England, and to play international football and have time on the ball, because that's what he created wherever he was. It's almost as if the level doesn't matter too much in some ways, and actually the higher the level, the better it's going to be, because you're going to play with better players. Is there an element of that with Jack Byrne, that he will actually get better the better players he plays with?
I don't subscribe to that, if I'm being honest with you. I think that Jack Byrne's a very, very good player. He needs to play in the right system. He needs to play, you know, he's admitted himself that he made mistakes going to Oldham and going up to Scotland and playing in difficult systems and being promised certain things by certain managers and they didn't come through. Jack has got to improve an awful lot in his game. I think one of the big aspects that he probably has to improve the most on is his defensive side of the game. Because whatever way you look at it now, the days of I won't say carrying a player because you don't carry Jack, you know, but when you don't have the ball, all 11 players have to be contributing to the game. And I think that is certainly an element of Jack's game that needs to be improved when they don't have the ball. And I'm not saying for a second here that he needs to be like a tough tackling midfield player or a dominant number six or anything, but he needs to contribute either that to his positional play, in closing people down and forcing people into certain areas. So there's things he can add to his game. And I think when you go to the UK, if he does want to go back to the UK, and that's a big ish, that's an aspect that he's going to have to improve, because when his team doesn't have the ball, he can't just kind of wait for his team to win it back and then give it to him again. He has, and I think that's reading between the lines, probably an issue is why he hasn't played more often for Mick, because Mick's that type of manager that he kind of prioritises not having the ball over actually having the ball. So, but tonight's kind of a free shot for him, hence the reason he's starting. So I hope he showcases his skills, and I hope he shows everyone what he's capable of.
It is definitely one of the things that we talked to Gary Breen about, the differences between the O'Neill era and the McCarthy era. He was saying that, or maybe it was Kenny actually, was making the point that when we're out of possession of the ball, you can see that there's a specific plan in place at the minute to try and get it back, that we're harrying and hassling as a team, which has worked on that. Now, I did want to bring up the last game where we went to three at the back, and apparently we didn't practice in training because we were concerned that perhaps we were being spied upon by our opponents. Does that make any sense?
I don't know if that's true or not. I don't think so. The last time when we went three at the back, my only query with that, with Mick, is we had two prototype Premier League wingbacks in Emma Stevens and Matt Doherty, and neither of them, Matt Doherty played left side of the three, and Doherty didn't play at all. So I thought it was a perfect example that if you were going to go three at the back, you could have played Kevin Long in there. In the back three on the left-hand side, and then played Enda in his wing-back position and Matt in his wing-back position. So that would kind of be my only question there with regards to why he went the way that he went. It's very strange not to practice a three at the back when you change a system that drastically. I don't know if that's true or not. They definitely was spoke about it, but it's very unlike Mick to go and do something like that anyway.
All of the information that we've had coming out of the camp was, and it hasn't been confirmed, so, you know, it's still in the realms of speculation, but it's informed speculation, is that the team didn't practice the three at the back all week in training, which is exactly what Martyn O'Neill was getting hammered for, that they weren't training for game situations. And Mick seems to have got away with that, despite the fact that here we are, we now have to beat Denmark on Monday to qualify, when actually really all we had to do was beat Georgia and we were going to go through.
It's very unlikely McCarthy to do that. And if that information that you're getting through there is accurate or even semi-accurate, I would be very, very surprised. And especially with the magnitude of the game that he did it in as well, because it was such a big, big game. So to throw kind of an unknown of the players as late as what he did is very surprising for me. I'm sure he had his reasons, and if you sat down and spoke to him, he probably had valid reasons for that. But it's very out of character for him, and perhaps he's just given that one pass, really.
Enda Stevens told us that they didn't practice it. He did the mix zone with Richie afterwards, and he was obviously quite disappointed, but he was like, no, we didn't actually. And when you consider that the centre-back, the constellation of centre-backs that we have at the minute, all of them, especially for this game, would all be comfortable with it. But apparently we've thrown that experiment out now because it didn't work in the half hour, 40 minutes that we've tried it. So that deal is done, that ship has sailed. Never again will you see that from Ireland.
Yeah, I think so. I don't know what Mick's thinking was behind that, but it was very unlike him. Maybe somebody convinced him to do it, or someone talked him around, one of his coaching staff. I couldn't even speculate on that. It's very unlike him, and I don't think we'll be seeing it again. But as I said, my only issue with it was, with the amount of centre-backs that we have, we could have picked three and played the two wing-backs who were playing in the Premier League. That would be my only question mark as to the bit I didn't understand about it, really.
Yeah, I don't think anybody understood it.
I was just illogical. Wondering, is he the kind of manager, if you didn't understand something or you're wondering, like we were just discussing there, is he the kind of manager that you can approach and say, I'm not sure this is the best idea, can we give it a whirl? Or is once he decides something's happening, that's it?
Well, you wouldn't go to Mick and say, can we practice something? Because then you'd be almost telling him what to do in his training sessions, or telling him how to put his training sessions together. And I don't think Mick would be...
So you can't say to him.
Yeah, wouldn't accept being told what to do. But look, I'm sure he had his reasons. It's definitely a character for him, whereas under Martyn, it was every camp that he did it. Perhaps he had valid reasons. I'm sure he did. He's not the type of manager that makes wild changes regularly. He's not that type of guy. He's a very structured, very measured man, and he thinks about everything that he does. So he had his reasons. I couldn't even begin to speculate what they were or why he did it. Perhaps afterwards he was annoyed with himself that he did go ahead and do it. But I don't think we'll be seeing it again. But to answer your question, no, Mick's probably not the person you probably could go and say that, to be honest with you.
It's a bit of a pity we won't see it again, because as you pointed out, we do have the two prototype wing-backs, but we also have centre-backs who are playing really well in the Premier League at the minute. Like, we could have three at the back, centre-backs, with Duffy and Clark and Egan, and it would be a completely different team, it would be a different style of play to what we've been using, but, like, it would have been presented to us by some of the most progressive minds in the Premier League, and we would suddenly have another way of playing that maybe tonight was the chance to try that out.
But see, the thing is, Mick's never going to risk any of his starters for Denmark tonight. You know, tonight is probably a game that Mick could have done without. He probably would rather not have it and then just keep everyone wrapped up. But he's playing all the guys who haven't been involved. There's a chance for Robbie Brady to stake a claim now and possibly force his way back into the starting 11 for the Denmark game. But as you said there, I agree with you. I think Shane Duffy's been playing that system at his club. John Egan plays it at his club. You could have, I mean, Kieran Clarke would be prototype left side of the three, really, more than capable of playing there. But then again, he's only come to the fore in the last couple of weeks at his club anyway. So before that, he was out of the picture. But I do think at the time, you would have had Kevin Long, who could have played that role. And then, you know, your two wing backs. So there's only one person that's not used to playing that role, whereas it was just a bit of a mixed match of players that were thrown together, and to do that in the magnitude of the game that he did is very, very surprising.
Yeah, it's baffling, really. In terms of the game against Denmark, is there anything apart from like a good performance from Robbie Brady tonight? If Troy Parrott scores two or three times, does that mean that he suddenly becomes a live option off the bench? Or like, is there anything that we can learn from tonight, really, beyond Brady?
No, I think probably the person that'll be watching tonight most closely will be Stephen Kenny if he goes ahead and gets the job, because he'll be looking to see how all these guys do. A lot of them are making their debuts. A lot of them, your first time playing at the Aviva in a full international game. So he'll be looking forward to seeing that. I think Mick, the only thing Troy Parrott can do tonight is probably, if he does really, really well, is if we're losing the game against Denmark later on, he might get himself thrown in the mix as a last throw of the dice with Jack Byrne. So if we're losing 1-0 with 10 minutes to go, you could probably see Jack Byrne and Troy Parrott on the pitch if Troy Parrott handles the situation tonight and then has a reasonably good game. But in terms of other players, I think Robbie Brady's the only one really that could force his way in. But even then, as I said to you, and I know the Switzerland game is out of character, Mick will have his team for Denmark sorted already, and he'll know exactly what he's going to do, and he'll have his plan in place.
So Brady has to have like the greatest game of all time, ping one in from a free kick,
because with the size of the game is coming up and the pressure is going to be on it. Robbie Brady's used to playing those types of games because he played at the Euros and he plays in big games for his clubs. So whereas you look at the other lads, you know, not a lot of them have played in his bigger game is what the Denmark is going to be. So if Robbie Brady has a stormer tonight, there's every chance you could see him in starting 11 on Monday against Denmark.
Because there is only really one spot up for grabs in the starting 11, it looks like. It's kind of that right side of the midfield area. Everywhere else has kind of melded into...
I think Mick's very rigid, very set in his ways. And as I said to you, I think Mick would be secretly hoping for Robbie to have a good game, because I have a feeling that he'd love to have Robbie in the team. I really do. I think he'd love to put him in because he's probably struggling for options there in the midfield, and he'd love to have a decision to make, let's put it that way. Whereas at the minute, if Robbie doesn't do well tonight, then I think the team almost picks itself.
Are we in danger of getting hammered again by Denmark on Monday night?
No, I don't think we'll get hammered. I don't think we do. I mean, you look back to the Denmark game, and not to rerun over that, but a lot of what was talking about was when he went to the Diamond, or we're nowhere, Martyn O'Neill. And the one thing you don't want to do against Christian Eriksen is go to a Diamond. I couldn't believe it when he did it at the time, because the one thing Christian Eriksen wants is space in between the midfield and back four. And I remember when we used to play against Spurs, that was the only thing that we used to say. So we used to play two number sixes to clog up that area, so Christian Eriksen couldn't get on the ball in between the two centre-backs and the two centre-midfielders. He had to go wide to get on the ball. And once he went wide to get on the ball, well, he couldn't hurt you directly from there. If you asked Christian Eriksen today what's the one system he'd want to play against, it would be the Diamond. Because the players on the either side of your Diamond, on the left and the right, are going to have to go up and help full-backs. So once they go up and help the full-backs and the ball gets played back inside, you have one number six, and then you've got huge, vast swaths of space there that Christian Eriksen can exploit. Hence the reason he absolutely took control of the game. So, I mean, that decision for me, I could never understand that. I could, it's the one thing you wouldn't do against Christian Eriksen, and he took advantage of it. So I think, to go back to your point, Mick will never do that because he would never, ever open up those spaces for... So I think we pretty much have two sixes to clog up those spaces for Christian Eriksen, keep the game at 0-0 or 1-0 either way and stay in the game and be able to shout with the last little bit. But, you know, the only way this ends up 4-5 is if there's 5 minutes left and we're 1-0 down and Jack throws on a load of attack, or Mick throws on a load of attackers, Jack Byrne and Troy Parrott, and they tack on a couple on the break in injury time. I think that's the only way.
Yeah, OK. The two number sixes who are going to end up having to deal with Eriksen on Monday night, obviously, we know Glenn Whelan's going to be one of those. Who else has that responsibility then?
I'd probably say it would be Conor Hourihan, I'd have thought.
Right, so he just plays very withdrawn then and barely moves forward.
Yeah, I don't think we'll be as attacking as what people are probably expecting for us to go and win the game. Because if you go attacking, you're going to open up those spaces for Eriksen and he's going to cause absolute carnage, as he did in the last game that we played against. So I think Mick's going to keep it nice and tight, nice and cagey, frustrate the Danes, kind of hopefully that if you're nice and solid, that they'll sack in frustrated, because they'll expect to be maybe 1-0 or 2-0 up early. Yeah, I know Kasper Schmeichel in the past has complained about playing against Irish teams.
Yeah.
So he's going to want to keep it tight, keep it cagey, stay in the game as long as possible, and do what he does, and that's a set piece or a penalty or a positive referee decision, something like that, and try to nick the game as opposed to actually going and dominating it, you know?
Yeah, sounds great.
It is what it is, and I think anyone's expecting champagne football and us to have 60% of the ball against Denmark. It's not going to happen. It's going to be exactly what we've had over the last number of games and qualifiers, you know?
Damien, good stuff. Great to have you with us this morning. Thanks a million, man.
So
it's Damien Delaney giving us some thoughts there.
Interesting.
It's
worrying.
Who we are. It's who we are.
I'm just thinking, like, can you imagine, fast forward to next Monday night, say Troy Parrott has a great game tonight, and then we're 1-0 down on Monday night and Mick McCarthy decides I'm going to throw him on. I'm wondering if you're ready on the field, are you going to be thinking, great, fresh legs, or, oh, jeepers, this is the Hail Mary, we're screwed. Like, how do you
respond?
Yeah.
Well, he's a 17-year-old, so it's obviously a last throw of the dice. And look, we know we're going to be in a playoff anyway. So that's what's coming. A weekend of playoffs next year.
Sure. Would we have it any other way?
Ireland against New Zealand live from the Aviva on OTB tonight. We're talking tennis next with Colm Boohig. First, after this break, we're going to bring you part of Vinnie Perth's incredibly honest interview on last night's show. Great stuff here.
OTB AM. This is OTB Sports Radio. OTB Gold. The very best of off the ball.
Are you crazy?
This is OTB Sports Radio. This week on OTB Gold.
You may say, why is he always talking about whites and blacks? Because everything happened to me is racial. It's all based on race and religion.
I was never as heavy as I was. I was 10 stone 11. And to lose that 7 pounds was torture.
I felt really, really empowered by running.
To be a minor in your county is really exciting.
The art of beating people is obviously you've got to have a trick. We know that. And it's got to work.
OTB Gold. The very best of off the ball. Weekdays from 1 p.m. and 6 p.m. This is OTB Sports Radio. OTB AM.
I understand, you know, you were in with Leinster having a look at how they do things. So this self-learning, this effort to improve all the time, and you said at the same time you're not an academic. Did you leave school early? Was that because of football or...?
No, it's just not my nature. I would... and I'm not shy about saying, and I actually hope it helps other people to say that... I mean, I don't know what the right word is where, like, I would be... I don't know whether it's even partially, or I don't know what the right word is, but I would struggle with literacy. Not like I can read and write, obviously, but I would have a certain amount of struggles with that.
So in like the kind of somewhere in the family of dyslexia.
Yeah, I'd be on that if it's called the spectrum is the right word. So it would be somewhere there. I would I would have done okay in school, but I would never have gone to the next stage.
And did anyone in school, because it's changed so much now, did anyone say to you, you know what, Finney, just looking at your work here, yeah. I think there may be something, did that happen? Or
no, and maybe this isn't it, but like it's a bit like I was very good at maths, but then when someone said on a test, a train leaves Dublin at 5 o'clock and it has to go to Cork and it takes 2 hours and that, if someone just gave me the sum, I would have done it. I've done it in my head as such.
So the language.
But the language and the way my brain picked it up was different. I'm not shy about talking about that. And then...
Well, there's nothing to be ashamed of.
No, and
did that make school an absolute nuisance and a nightmare, or was that okay?
No, and I'd done quite well in school, but then come test time, people didn't understand it, and they didn't... Well, how did he do this? And back then, we had the highest class and the middle class and the lower class, and I was always in the highest class. I wasn't shy about speaking up, and... So I'd done well in the actual work, but then when it came to test time, I probably struggled.
Imagine dog manager Vinnie Pert there speaking with Joe last night. It's great stuff there, and you should get that on our YouTube channel or offtheball.com/podcast and indeed on the Goal Out app as well. Now, Colm Boohig is here to talk to us about the end of year. It's the end of year proper.
End of year, last ATP tournament of the year. It all builds
the
up
money.
To this.
This is the money.
Money, but it's also esteem. It's the top eight players in the world going off, and it's a right laugh.
It's the money.
It's not that, like, it's only a couple of million.
Is it?
Is that all?
No.
Why would you bother?
It's not. The women's was 3 million last week.
Yeah.
Winner.
Same.
So it's only a couple of million.
Yeah, but it just tops it up. But it's all about the esteem. It's the top eight players in the world. And the best thing is they're absolutely knackered, so they just give it up their all because they can't wait for the season to end. But it's so different to any other tennis tournament because it's like in the O2 in London, indoor, lights are out, it's dark, dimmed lights, bombastic music. It's needless pageantry at its best. I love it.
With exhausted tennis players playing for just a couple of million. I can see the appeal.
Oh, it's unbelievable. It's best of three sets too, so they just fly through the matches.
Do you remember Lendl won the gold racket? That was for this. This was like the end of the year. It was like, it was the most important thing to him. He was like, yeah, this is a gold racket made of gold and diamonds.
Yeah. No, it's been great so far. Like Federer has won the most. He's won the most amount. He won six times, but he has won since 2011. So he's wanting to top that up. That was against Joe Wilfred Tsonga. Then you have Novak Djokovic. He's won it five times, but he hasn't won it since 2015. And then you have Rafa Nadal, who actually hasn't won it at all. He's never won it. He's lost two finals in 2010 and 2013. So you have the big three in it this year, but you also have another five players, and three of those players, they're really the hope that we have for the next generation that they're going to be any bit good at all.
Who?
It's Alexander Zverev, Daniil Medvedev, and Stefanos Tsitsipas. So Zverev is actually the defending champion here. He won it last year. He beat Djokovic in the final. He beat Federer in the semi-final. And this year already, he's beat Nadal in the first match. So he has acumen. His breakthrough year was last year in 2018. He won four tournaments. He's only won one this year. Right. So he's gone off the boil a bit. And he had an absolute disaster match yesterday against Tsitsipas. He started going on his phone in second set, just flicking through his phone in the change events.
Did that?
Yeah. No, they're not allowed to do that. He's going to get fined for that. So
why did he have it with him?
He had it in his bag. And everything in their bag.
Leave it in the...
But that's the beauty of this tournament. It's all over the place.
Would you argue then that the reason like the Federers and the Nadals of the world haven't won it is because they've been busy winning real tournaments and they just don't care?
It all comes down to the focus. You know, we've discussed this before here where you're saying like there's no hope beyond the big three.
Tennis is over.
But like these guys, those three guys that I've named, they're seriously talented. The difference is they don't have the focus. They don't have the consistent focus. So going into
skill.
This... Well, no, they have serious skill because all of those guys I've named
have beaten
the big three several times.
Now, Medvedev did just choke yesterday.
Oh, it was unbelievable. So he's in group Andre Agassi. So there's two groups of four. So group Andre Agassi is his one. So that's Nadal, Tsitsipas.
Agassi died, and did he miss that bit? Or like, I mean,
I know the other one's group Bjorn Borg. So I don't know. It's just in tribute to living legends.
Right.
But no, Medvedev was so far ahead. He lost his first match against Tsitsipas. They don't like each other too, so it was an interesting dynamic. Yesterday, he was 5-1 up in the final set. And Nadal had a drop shot. He just went for it because he thought the match was finished. And it was an unbelievable drop shot. And he got it. Then Medvedev went on to have a match point, lost that. Nadal won the match, threw it all away. But Medvedev threw it all away. The narrative going into this week has all been about Nadal. He is world number one going into this, but he could lose world number one if Djokovic wins the tournament. As I say, Nadal's never won this tournament. He's not mad about it because it's on hard court. He wants it on clay. And next week is the Davis Cup in Madrid. So he's kind of focusing on that. He's pulled out of his last two tournaments injured. And after the first game on Monday against Zverev, where he lost, and he was abject against Zverev, Nadal. He was really terrible. He was very angry at himself in the press conference. But in the press conference, he was asked by a journalist if the recent marriage to his long-term partner had an effect on his performance. And here's what happened.
Well, tonight you were playing very short many times. I don't know why, because you're not used to that. But I'd like to know, for many people to get married is a very important and destructive thing. Mm. Before the marriage, during the marriage, after the marriage. Your concentration on tennis life has been a bit different, even if you were going out with the...
Honestly, are you asking me this? Yeah. Is it a serious question or is it a joke? Is it serious? Yeah. It's a big surprise for me you ask me this after being with the same girl for 15 years and having a very stable and normal life. Doesn't matter if you put a ring on your finger or not. In my personal way, I am a very normal guy. Maybe for you was it the complete... How many years you have been with your...
Wife, 30 years this year, but...
And before the... After... Ah, maybe you were not sure. That's why. It's okay. Okay, we move to Spanish because that's bullshit.
He never curses.
Never.
That was something in itself, to wait till the end of it. But it was great because he was so angry with himself, Nadal, after that performance. He was much better yesterday against Medvedev, but Nadal said himself that he was incredibly lucky to win that match. He said it was a 1 in 1,000 match. So if Nadal had lost that match yesterday against Medvedev, he was essentially out. Now, he wasn't technically out because of the way that group has gone, the Andre Agassi group. So going into the last match, Nadal, he very much has a chance to go through, but it's not in his hands. He has to beat Tsitsipas, who's won his first two matches, but then he has to hope that Medvedev does him a favour against Zverev to go through. And if that doesn't happen, then he's out. And it's all in Djokovic's hands to claim the world number one spot. So speaking of, that's the other group, Group Bjornborg. So that's Djokovic, Federer, Berrettini and Dominic Thiem. Dominic Thiem has been the star of the show so far. He beat Djokovic and Federer in the space of 48 hours this week already. So he beat Djokovic first. He beat Federer first in straight sets, 7-5, 7-5. Federer was pretty much out of sorts in that match. Against Djokovic, it was an unbelievable match. It was actually the first three-setter match of the tournament so far. That was on Tuesday night. But, like, it was I don't know what happened to him because he's a pretty mild-mannered guy. Like, he's 26. The guys I mentioned, they're all early 20s. So he's kind of stands out in the middle. And I mean that in every way, kind of the most average. But he's just a solid guy who accumulates points over the years. He kind of doesn't have anything about him, really. But whatever happened in the second set against Djokovic, he lost the first set. And he just went for it. He hit 51 winners for the rest of the match. Like
51.
He just started going for everything in just a wild way. Like, it was the ultimate example of a guy or anyone in any walk of life just saying, oh, I don't care anymore. I'm just going to go for it.
And it worked.
Like, what's to lose? And he said afterwards, it's the best match he's ever played. And the thing with Djokovic is, when Djokovic plays well on a hard court, he wins the match all the time. Djokovic played really well, so he was fuming afterwards with himself. Like, he was all congratulations to the team, but he couldn't believe he lost, because usually to beat Djokovic he has to be some way off form, but team was just that good. And that goes to show that these guys can beat the big three regularly. They just can't put the consistency through. They don't really have the belief either, and the three guys are still very much remaining.
So there's a big game tonight, right? Federer against Djokovic.
Oh, it's unbelievable, because as I say, team's beaten both of them, and two of them have beaten the other guy in the group, Matteo Berrettini. He's the Italian. First time around, he was the number 8 player, like 8 of 8 to get in. Kind of overwhelmed with the whole experience because he just got in the last minute ahead of game on fee. So he's been wiped out by Federer and Djokovic so far. So there's the first dead rubber matches this afternoon between Thiem and Berrettini. Mm-hmm. And then tonight, it's Djokovic against Federer. It's the first time they played each other since the Wimbledon final, which I don't know if you remember, the 4 hours and 57 minutes, Federer had 2 championship points and lost. So this is the first time they've played each other since. And for any tennis fan, even if a casual tennis fan, tonight's going to be unbelievable because it's make or break. Whoever wins goes through with Dominic Thiem.
Where is it on?
The O2 in London.
No, and on TV.
Amazon Prime tonight. And it's on BBC Two during the day. So the afternoon matches are being put on BBC Two.
Okay, but
Amazon Prime
has
the whole thing. Yeah. So yesterday they had Nadal, Medvedev was on. Or Nadal, yeah.
And where's my buddy Nick Kyrgios?
He's nowhere to be seen.
Hey,
so
what a surprise.
He's serving a 6-month probation period for his lash out of the Cincinnati Masters, he went into the back and just got his racket and started smacking it in the back. Got like a six-figure fine, six-month probation. Hasn't played since the end of September at a tournament in China. He's actually playing next week at the Davis Cup because you're allowed to play in that. Doesn't count as the ATP, but he's nowhere to be seen, like, because it is. But also, he called the ATP pretty corrupt.
Right.
So that was part of the main reason.
He just keeps giving, doesn't he?
He's unbelievable, yeah. But he's very much out of the picture. He's never been in this top eight, Clash.
What a surprise.
Yeah, but it's all about tonight.
Yes.
It's going to be unbelievable. Federer, Djokovic, it's make or break. It's basically Wimbledon all over again, except it's best of three in this theatre, where it's just complete showbiz.
Is there a Now TV for Amazon Prime where you can just pay for the tenner, or do you have to sign up for the whole thing?
I mean, I would very much try it.
Okay.
Not sure.
Right. Good stuff, Colm. Thanks for that. So it's 9:15 this morning here on OTB AM this Thursday morning. We've got cycling up next. We're going to speak with Martyn Irvine, who's going to talk to us about Ireland's first gold in the World Track Cycling Championships, World Cup Cycling Championships in 155 years. Here's Tim Vickery talking Brazilian football on last night's show next.
The parts aren't quite gelling. When the coach Chuchu, when he took over late 2016, second half of 2016, everything clicked instantly. At the moment, nothing is clicking. And part of the explanation for that, I think, could be that he's got a little bit of Liverpool and a little bit of Manchester City, and it's not quite working. I'll explain that. Mm. He's still haunted, I think, by that World Cup quarterfinal defeat against Belgium when he came to the conclusion that he'd left his side too open against quality opponents. So how has he tried to balance things up subsequently? He's changed the fullbacks, or they've changed the role of the fullbacks. He now wants the fullbacks not to be auxiliary wingers, as they've been in Brazil for so long. You remember your Cafu and Roberto Carlos bursting up and down the flank. Instead of that, he wants them just to tuck in, be auxiliary midfielders as well, and maybe get forward from time to time as an element of surprise. It's a less physically grueling role. It helps explain why Daniel Alves, although he's not available for these games, that Brazil haven't picked any home base players. Why Daniel Alves, even at his advanced age, is still in the frame for Brazil and is still the captain. And the coach said to me, he said, "What we want now, we don't want Liverpool fullbacks. We want Manchester City fullbacks." Hmm. But he's got the Liverpool centre forward, Roberto Firmino, and they haven't been able to get the best out of him.
Yeah, so why Firmino doesn't work for Brazil, more of that good stuff from Tim Vickery, wherever you get your podcast. So the Goal Out app or offtheball.com/podcast. 9:16 this morning, I'm delighted to say Martyn Irvine is with us in studio to talk to us about Felix English, who won gold in the scratch race at the UCI Track World Cup in Glasgow on Sunday. That's not a bad achievement for him, is it?
No, it's good. I mean, he's probably due it for years, you know. But yeah, it's nice to see a bit of the training paying off. You know, a lot of the guys spend a lot of time out in Mallorca where we train, so it's nice to get something back for all the hard work.
Okay, we'll go into him in a minute, because you bring up Mallorca. Why do you train in Mallorca?
Because the weather's nice. There's a velodrome. There's a velodrome there.
Yeah, so we don't have a velodrome.
Yeah.
But we're getting one.
Apparently so.
Right, what's the story?
So all I know is there's a pot of money allocated for a velodrome out in the sports campus. And I was the first to say I'll believe it when I see it, but there was an army of people in Glasgow last week looking at the hows and whens and whos and ifs, so it looks pretty real. I think it's to be, like, they want it to be started this time next year, so it looks more promising than ever.
So started in 2020 and then maybe finished by, does it take a year, does it take 2 years?
I don't know, yeah, I really don't know.
How long would it take to build a velodrome?
I would think so. I mean, there's a lot. Obviously, there's the wooden part, which is special. There's lots of degrees and all that sort of thing. And then the actual arena and whatever facilities around it, yeah.
Yeah.
I could be wrong.
Will that be a transformative moment in Irish cycling?
100%, yeah. I mean, we have good track cyclists because they're people who find out later in life that they like cycling, and then they go off and find a velodrome and then try and get good at it. But if you were on a velodrome from this, you know, from knee high, you'll just have all these skills just bet into you that you don't even know, you know, and we'll just have better bike riders.
When did you discover that you were good and wanted to go on?
I'm still questioning if I'm any good. But I didn't start till I was 18 really proper riding a bike. So there's 10 years lost of skills and everything.
Just gonna say you're up against people who will probably start at what, 6, 7, 8?
100%. I mean, there's kids in Mallorca where we train like once or twice a week. You'll see, I think it's like a school comes in and they can barely get on bikes. You can barely get bikes to fit them. You know, they're tiny.
But they're zipping up and down.
And they're flying around. They scare you, like. Yeah, it's amazing.
They have no fear at that age, though.
Fearless is right, yeah. And then that's the sort of thing that we're lacking in a group, you know. You just talent shines through eventually, but if you had a 100 people to throw at it, you'll get one or two good ones.
Yeah.
You know? If you had thousands, it'd be even more.
Our tradition of cycling is surely something, and the growth in cycling in Ireland over the last 15, 20 years, it's become a massive thing.
Yeah.
Within that, when you kind of filter it down, there's bound to be some people who are talented at the track. We just don't have the facilities
100%, to. Yeah. It's just, like, I mean, cycling now is becoming a victim of its own success. There's so many accidents, there's just loads of people doing it. So, and even in my head, the velodrome is like a safe place to just throw a load of cyclists and let them train away there. Even for kids too, you know, it'll definitely boost high performance and just general cycling activity, I think.
Can you take us back then, sorry, briefly to your own bit, where what were you doing between 8 and 18 that you were obviously fairly proficient at sport and quite athletic to the point where you can then take up track cycling and become a world champion?
I was just getting up to no good, running around, doing no sport. Like, I hated sport. Like, I've said all this before, but, like, I hated PE. I hated any sort of sport in school, but it was always running about the place, so activity. And then I just happened to stumble into cycling when I was working as a car mechanic. It was just people I knew got me into it. And I was stupid enough to keep doing it, and it paid off eventually. But
so you had no athletic training?
No,
you didn't?
No, absolutely.
Did you run as a kid? Did you just row?
Like, if I ran upstairs, I thought I was doing well. You know, it was really, I didn't do anything.
Just hope for us all.
Yeah. And then.
So the first time you get on a bike, what happens? Like, properly, someone gets you a nice bike and you're like, ooh, this is.
Well, yeah, it was a slow, when I say slow, probably happened over a few months. I just liked the feeling of hurting myself. Like, it sounds stupid looking back, but there's a sense of achievement or something, you know? And then, like, I never even, where I lived in Ards, I never even got out of town. And then when I was cycling, I just got out of town. It was like, whew. And within a year, travelling all over the place, it was brilliant. So I look back with fond memories in the old cycling game, yeah.
I'm sure, because when you finished, was it automatic that you were going to go and become a coach?
Not at all, no. There was limbo there, you know. There was no, I suppose, with the small nation we are, we don't have a big factory of people to throw people back into, you know. So it's a niche setup, so I'm kind of lucky to get back into it again.
How did that happen?
Just good timing, I think. There was a coach coming out as I was on the road then, on a road team, and it kind of went sour. So I was idle for a few months. I had no job for a while, and then all of a sudden there was this track opportunity, and I was like, I know how track cycling works, and then it just natural sort of, it was obvious pathway.
Right. So I loads of people go, I want to be this thing, but actually learning how to become a coach and coaching people
I'm very rookie as it comes to coach. I know how I did it. It's managing people's the hardest part now. So you've got egos and expectations of other people that you got to try and manage. So
yeah.
I'm very much struggling with that at the minute.
But who do you turn to for help?
There's head coaches, and there's even your peers. You know, there's other coaches at the track. You know, there's a coach, the performance director, the minute coached me and went back. He goes right back since I started cycling. So there's always friendly ear around. But like I say, it's a handful of people. You know,
officially the Irish setup?
Yeah,
it's all part of Cycling Ireland. Is that the
Cycling Ireland? Yeah.
Okay, so you're an employee of theirs, and because Mallorca is the best place. For the weather and the velodrome.
It's great weather.
That's nice.
Yeah. I mean, it is, but it's not, because, like, even as me coaching, I've been home like 15 days in the last 6 months. Barely home. So I have a wife at home. So that's just me, but that's my choice. But for the athletes, they're living away. And on your downtime, there's nothing really to do unless you're good at Spanish. So it's definitely. We could be better high performance because we're sacrificing so much, you know. It's very tunnel vision, so not a lot of people can do that. That's sort of one single minded.
Well, I mean, it has mental health issues. We've seen that with anybody who goes touring or.
Yeah. Like I wouldn't say I was really depressed, but I definitely, you go into the doldrums, like when you have a lot of downtime or bad results or injuries.
When you were competing?
Problems. Yeah, for sure, yeah. It's very, very much a roller coaster.
A lot of spare time to be thinking about things that went wrong and over ruminating it, not coming up with the right kind of thoughts.
That's the worst time, the idle time. There's a lot of, for all the hard work you do, there's 10 times that of rest. So you're a lot of time to sit and think.
And would you have your rest time ever kind of segmented out, like you're going to do this for this hour, that for that hour, or was it just go rest and then you were kind of left to your own devices to rest?
Just, yeah, going. That's what made me really good. I was really good at being lazy, so I could just rest. And I swear, that's where I think I got good, because when I rested, I just lay about like a sloth, you know, and I think that helped me, but it's not for everyone, that's pretty extreme.
So tell us about Felix winning at the weekend then. He's been fourth and fifth at about 12 different World Cups.
It's probably an insult what I'm going to say, but if I had half the talent that Felix had, I'd be world champion a few times over, I reckon. He's just got this natural craft, track craft, and he's fast. Yet he's just not had the breakthrough the last few years. Even for me, when I was out of the system looking in, you'd see him getting nearly results. So it's definitely long overdue, that, for Felix. And then when it all clicked right for him, he was a level up on that race. You know, it was good to be there. I was a track coach, I was trackside helping him out, so it was good to be standing there looking at that. Yeah.
What point in the race do you know it's going to happen when you're watching?
I think halfway through he had a lap on there, you know, because there's only 250 metres around. So if you can go really quickly for 250 metres, you can get a lap up on the bunch you're in. So he got that straight away, and then he got another lap up. So there was only one or two people who was racing. So it was really easy to watch and follow. It was like almost a guarantee by halfway that we had a medal anyway. So
yeah,
it was nice to be there. Yeah.
And for him, is this the big breakthrough?
I'm hoping that's a mental switch for him, because he's been like just banging his head against the wall, you know. And now with the Olympics coming down the barrel, a nice positive result should get him going in the right way. You know, he can hopefully that's a boost mentally, that he can just kind of carry that momentum into the rest of the season.
How many can we qualify for the Olympics? What's realistic?
I think realistically we could have like road and track, or just track?
Just track to start with.
You definitely, like, so the Madison is the main Olympic event that we focus on, which is the pairings where the hands sling each other in. So that two pairings is best case scenario, I think.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Would that be the first time we've had two pairings?
Oh, for sure. I mean, we've only ever had one track athlete the last three Olympic cycles. I was one of them. Shannon McCurley was one. And then I think David O'Loughlin back in Beijing. So we've only ever had one representative. So
right. So that would be...
Even half of that quota filled is 100% up on the years before. So
yeah.
Yeah.
But when you think about it, when you're competing against the best in the world in a four-year cycle, you don't even have a velodrome to just have one in there at all. It's quite an achievement.
Yeah, that's the whole other element, you know. When it's just special people that have to go in real tunnel vision to focus on it, because it's not like the British have a heap of people they can throw at it, you know. So it'll definitely be a good achievement if we get that.
Track cycling's mad, right? It's mad. It's a mad thing to do. It's a mad thing to be attracted to. It's a mad thing to even find out about.
All day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How did you even find out about it? Like, did you not want to be a road racer?
I was road racing in Belgium, trying to be the pro, you know. Yes. And then I got sick of that, and there just happens to be a velodrome over there. And like I say, the performance director now was a coach back then who said, "Why don't you try this track thing?"
Okay, so you were kind of scouted.
Pure circumstance, yeah. And then I wasn't bad at it, and then it just kind of. I think that was even Beijing when I started. I came in really late into that Beijing cycle, on like 21 or something. And then I just haven't stopped since.
It is a type of thing where you watch the Olympics and it's class.
Yeah.
And then everybody forgets about it again until it comes on again in the Olympics.
Yeah.
Particularly in this country, because there's nowhere to try it. So, like, generally, there's an argument being made historically that we're very well served with most sports facilities in this country. What we need are coaches to come and inform people how to use the stuff when they get there and to progress. With this, you can definitely see the case that if you build it, and give people the example of it, and open it up to the public. Like, it must be cool to cycle in the velodrome.
See, once you do it, there's very few people I've seen, I'm not doing that again. There's such a buzz from it, because just the banking, you're up two stories on when you're on the fence, you know, from the ground, and the momentum on it is awesome, the speed is awesome, and it's kind of like adrenaline buzz. And I think it's like, even if you look at the British system, if you go back to the 90s, they had no tracks, and then they just started putting money in there, and all of a sudden, they're dominant. They're really dominant. So.
They are really dominant. There are some reasons for their dominance that are beginning to come a bit clearer this week from the Freeman and Sutton stuff.
I suppose that's a victim of their success, but at our level, it's all just hard work that's getting our little few eager beavers to get the results. You know?
Is everybody gossiping about the Freeman and Sutton stuff around the track? Is it like, oh, did you see what
it's
happened
today? No, to be honest, not at all. It's literally a bubble we're in, and I don't even know what time of day it is when we're at the track. The last in Glasgow, Minsk, this is our World Cup season, so we're just in our job, focusing on what we're doing, and I couldn't tell you what's going on in the world. to be honest.
I mean, are you interested in what's going on in British cycling? Because it, like, they come out and they were like, oh, look at us, we're the best because we're the best and we do this and we do this and you're never going to catch us. And now it turns out that we can't believe anything that they've been up to.
That's just a bad side effect of being British, I think, isn't it? I think they'd be saying that either way. But no, we'll just stick to what we were doing. And I, like, even when I did it, I was a firm believer of if you want it enough and hard work and if coaches are in the right place and kind of help you.
Yeah,
you
and so as an athlete now, though, do you still believe that when you look back at the people who might have been beating you and think, because, like, we, you know, various people, I did a thing with Jessica Ennis recently and she won a gold she got retrospectively and was like, it's not quite the same, yeah. You know? And there's definitely the sense of having had stuff taken off you that you didn't, that you deserved, that you had done the hard work for.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose what can I control of that, you know? I mean, it's your own scruples, isn't it? It's what we, there's a bad, I think it's almost a bad side effect of being Irish now, is you're just, the guilt will get you. And that's kind of where I think, I couldn't look you in the eye if I was cheating or, that's the way I looked at it. And that's the way I think the majority of Irish athletes are, so.
Do you feel like the athletes need to talk about it? Because Kieran McGean comes in here and says, you know, the time that won the race that I ran in, I'm never going to be able to run that time clean. And I'm not sure that a lot of people in the world can run that time clean. And she's actually out there saying, this is ridiculous. Like, those cheats, the Oregon project is dirty. Like, all that kind of stuff is happening now. And it feels to me like we all need to be able to get behind the people who are wearing our jerseys. And we're desperate to get behind them. Yeah. But we just need to have that kind of sense that, okay, we're all in this together. And the point you make about Irish athletes, it'd be great to hear a bit more from the Irish athletes like Kira.
I think that momentum's going that way, the lid's being lifted on things and people are being more vocal. I mean, I think that's we're going that way now, that there's more and more stories coming out. And I think it's only natural that eventually they'll get caught. Obviously, careers have come and gone while people have been cheating, but we can't change it. We just need to keep, like you guys talking about it now, we need to make it more public and make it more of a point.
I want the athletes to be more vocal too, because I can definitely get behind them. I don't care if an Irish athlete finishes seventh, but they, like, reach their absolute peak and we think that seven ahead or five of the people ahead of them are cheating. I don't mind if we're not the best in the world, but if we're doing the best that we can do clean and our athletes are, like, properly advocating for clean sport, then we can all get behind that and we can all continue to invest in that time and energy and resources and the love of the sport.
I think the more common it is to talk about it and the more sponsors will want to talk about it. Obviously, that's the problem. Athletes are scared to say anything in case some sponsor goes,
The trouble, isn't it? You're finishing fifth and sixth instead of second and third or first, and therefore your sponsorship isn't as big as it could be and all this kind of stuff.
Yeah. And you're in that catch where you're like, if you say something, you get nothing. But I suppose if you're twisted in mind, you need to do this to be there. And that's the kind of catch people are in. But like I say, that Irishness in a lot of us, we don't want to do that.
Fair enough. What's the rest of the year like for you guys?
Manic, actually, for the track. I'm home for a whole 4 or 5 days here, and then we go Hong Kong, New Zealand, Australia, and then home just for Christmas.
Right.
So there's 3 World Cups on the bounce.
In between now and Christmas, you're in. Wow.
Yeah.
That's quite the air miles.
It is, yeah. So I'm going to Mallorca this weekend to do a little week of training, packing, and then on the road show.
Right. Well, listen, when will we find out about the two Madison teams? When is that qualification?
I suppose you'll know after Christmas. It goes right up to the World Championships in February, so that's the official deadline. It'll probably, knowing track cycling, it'll go to the wire, so it'll probably be next February before it's locked up.
Well, listen, best of luck with that, and thanks a million for joining us today.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Cheers.
That's our lot for this morning. We're live from the Aviva this evening for Ireland against New Zealand for our hotly anticipated clash with the All Whites. Back from 7:30 tomorrow with Ronan O'Gara and Alan Quinlan and much more. You can podcast this show. It's fully time-stamped and you can flick through it as you go if you want to go a la carte. Do yourself a favour, make some time for the Gatland and Vinnie Perth interviews from last night's show. Both brilliant. They're also on YouTube. You can subscribe while you're there and you can Chromecast that or get OTB in your smart TV or on Apple TV as well. OTB Sports Radio live all day, of course, on the Go Loud app. We'll see you tomorrow. Good luck.
OTB AM. This is OTB Sports Radio.